Good evening, friends. I'm really delighted to welcome you to this course, a webinar, a video bouquet of ECHO, basic to advanced, and this is the part one of this program. This particular course has traveled places. It has gone for the last 10, 15 years, and during the journey, we have been able to associate with some of the luminaries of the international fame from the United States as well as in the country. So I'm really happy to have Dr. Haripriya and Dr. Madhushekar around with me to moderate and coordinate the session. We have the international stars from USA, and then of course the superstars, the young superstars who are going to lead the show in the Indian firmament in a couple of years' time, and they have already arrived. So, I would like to thank Dr. Mahipal Sajdev, the president of All India Ophthalmic Society, who is also the chairman scientific committee of IRSI, chairman and managing director of the Center for Sight Group of Eye Hospitals. Dr. Mahipal has really been a visionary. What I like most about him, his decisiveness, his pragmatic nature. And I always say, come at the time, come at the man. We are going through a difficult time in All India Ophthalmic Society, and he has done a very good work for the 25,000 members of the society in our country. And at the end of introduction, I'll ask Dr. Mahipal to say a few introductory words. And then also I'd like to thank Professor Dr. Namrata Sharma, the Secretary of All India Ophthalmic Society, who is also a senior consultant in the cataract, cornea and refractive services at the RP Center, AIIMS, New Delhi. She is not only a great academician, but she is a human dynamo, full of enterprise, full of energy. In addition to all the publications and all the frontier work that she does, she also is a very, very able assistant to our dynamic president. So thank you, Dr. Namrata, for making it possible for us to go through this program. And then let me introduce you to the stellar speakers, Dr. Uday Devgan. Everybody in India knows him because of his very famous website, and I'll be coming to it a little while from now. He is currently in private ophthalmic practice, Devgan Eye Surgery in LA. He has done more than 20,000 ocular surgeries. Academically, he is the clinical professor of ophthalmology at Jules Stein Eye Institute, UCLA School of Medicine. He has won numerous awards, four-time winner of the UCLA JSI Surgical Teaching Award, key opinion leader as an ophthalmic teacher and a presenter. He has published numerous papers. He has authored multiple books, and he has more than 3,300 articles written. And his website, cataractcoach.com, actually is a byword in Indian ophthalmology today. All the residents and everybody, even I also follow his website. So he will be talking to us on two topics: the twist technique to expand IOLs and paired phaco incisions to treat astigmatism. Then we'll have Dr. Aiki Ahmed. Aiki has been a great friend, and we have done a lot of courses together for the last maybe 10, 15 years. Aiki is a leader in novel treatments for glaucoma, cataract, and lens implant surgery. He's coined the term microincision glaucoma surgery, MIGS. It is his baby. He's an associate professor at the University of Toronto and professor at the University of Utah, research director and director of the Glaucoma and Advanced Anterior Segment Surgery Fellowship at University of Toronto, head of the ophthalmology division at the Trilium Health Partners in Ontario, and one of the most experienced complex eye surgeons in the world. Some of the kind of cases that he has taken up, and we have been fortunate to witness those cases in the social media, they're just unbelievable. Absolute, tremendous contributions to ophthalmology eye care. And then we have Dr. Thomas Oding, again, a good friend of mine for a long period of time. Tom will be joining us shortly. He is currently the professor of ophthalmology, education, and the residency program director at the University of Iowa. It is interesting to note that he studied engineering as an undergraduate as well as a graduate student at Duke University, and he continued his medical schooling and residency at the same place. He did his residency at Iowa. He has been active in the ASCRS, served as a chair of the ASCRS Cataract Skills Transfer Subcommittee and the Education Committee. He's also been very active at the American Academy of Ophthalmology, leading several committees. You know, for example, the preferred practice patterns, etc. He has been a trustee at large on the AAO Board of Trustees. He also has been a founder and really involved, deeply involved with another website, irounds.org, which is also hugely popular in the subcontinent in India. So he'll be talking to us on tips for weak zonules. And then we have Dr. Haripriya Arvind. Haripriya is currently the head of cataract and IR services at Arvind Eye Hospitals in Chennai. Her area of interest is quality assurance amongst patients undergoing cataract surgery. And she has developed a system and tools to monitor outcomes following cataract surgery. She is also interested in performing surgery on complicated cataracts. And her recent articles and peer-reviewed literature has changed the way we practice cataract surgery today. We practice ophthalmology today. Antibiotic prophylaxis study, you know, to reduce post-op endophthalmitis, 2 million eyes. And then she also has done a large study on pseudoexfoliation and cataract with more than 1,000 patients. And for which, for the first study, she was the recipient of the OPSPOM Award for the best paper in JCRS. Madhu Shekhar Regan is a very young, dynamic cataract surgeon trained by Haripriya. And today he is in charge of the cataract and IR department at Arvind Madurai, the largest eye hospital in the world. He is a left-handed surgeon, so he brings a lot of new perspectives to cataract training. He's already done more than 20,000 cataract surgeries, including 500 flaps. He has been performing live surgeries in state conferences. And again, in all the, he has been doing a lot of complex cases and teaching in a lot of websites and a lot of programs. And then we have the other speakers, Dr. Deepak Megur, who is from Megur Eye Care Center, Bidar, Karnataka. He has, right from his formative days, I have known him. He has a very incisive mind, he's a great surgeon. And his video, he's well known all over the country for his video recording. In 2020 All India Conference, he was awarded the C.S. Reshmi Best Video Award. He also got the best paper of the session in cataract in AIC meeting 2018. And a lot of best papers and awards for him. And a couple of audition awards also goes to his credit. So far, more than 200 presentations at different meetings. He's also a reviewer for IJO. Saurabh Patwardhan, again, is a very brilliant mind. And I have also known him for a long time. He's, the ophthalmology runs in his blood, I think. He's a third generation ophthalmologist. He's the director, Nandadeep Eye Hospital and PG Institute, head of FECO training and fellowship program. And he is a very enterprising surgeon. He's a very innovative surgeon. He also has a website, cataract teaching website, fecotraining.org, which I know has been doing extremely well. A lot of people have been benefited from that. And he has invented a lot of devices. iToric Patwardhan is a good app for toric IOLs, and a lot of devices that are you know, that come under his belt. And last but not the least, Dr. Shail. He is, I think, you know, the youngest of the speakers today, but he's a great surgeon. He has a great, he's a good speaker. He has tremendous clarity of mind and clarity of thought. And he is at present a cataract and refractive consultant in Raghudeep Eye Hospital, Ahmedabad. He does a lot of challenging cases. He does a lot of femtolaser assisted cataract surgery. He has did the international training at Moran Eye Center in Salt Lake City, Utah. He has more than 15 peer-reviewed publications, reviewed in multiple prestigious journals, and multiple best paper winners and multiple best video grand prize winners of different of various conferences. Sayan Das is, again, a very enterprising surgeon from Calcutta, the place where I belong to originally. And he also he's basically interested in cornea. He did an observership in Orbis in 2013. He does all kinds of complex situations, complex cataract surgeries, corneal surgeries, and he will be dazzling us with a couple of videos that you know, he has edited for the meeting today, for the webinar today. So this is the schedule. Shail, please get ready. He will be he has two talks. First talk is reverse optic capture, special situations, and then we'll have a panel discussion. Then the field will be taken by Dr. Uday Devgan. He will have two topics: twist technique to expand intraocular lenses and paired phaco incisions to treat astigmatism. Then I'll be speaking on pupillary snap, its sequelae, and how to avoid it. Aiki is the next person to take stage, and he'll be telling us on capsular excess tricks. Deepak Negur on calcified capsule. Tom will be telling us about tips for weak zonules. And finally, we'll have Sayan Das and Saurabh Patwardhan telling us about the issues pertaining to toric intraocular lens implantation. Shail also will then go on to talking about incisions. If time permits, Deepak will talk about posterior polar cataract. Actually, this was the best video that was, you know, the grand prize, that video that won the grand prize in the AIC meeting this year. And Sayan also will be showing us a very challenging case, hypermature swollen lens with camouflage ultra-hard nucleus. So with these few words of introduction, I would now request the president as well as the secretary to introduce the program to the webinar, to the AIS membership, and welcome the faculty and the participants.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Conducts this video course for the last several years, and they are jam-packed. And I think the faculty that they participate, they draw the crowds. I think I've always seen people standing in this course, whether it's the Ascaris or the AAO. And the reason for that is that these tips that the faculty gives here are really fantastic, and cataract surgery being the commonest surgery that any ophthalmologist performs, I think they draw a huge crowds for people to understand the fine nuances and fine tricks of handling most difficult cases of cataract. And I'm sure this particular webinar, I think webinars are becoming the new normal, and I think they are bringing us all across the globe, people much closer, and we are able to meet our friends more often than we were ever before. So I think this webinar would be a great learning for all the members. I think there are a lot of people who will be watching this both nationally and internationally, and simultaneously on the AIOS Facebook page and the YouTube, it will be broadcast live. So I don't want to stand between the speakers and the audience, and without much ado, I'll just ask Dr. Namrata to say a few words, and then I think Arup, you can take over. Thank you very much, everybody, for participating once again.
So congratulations, Dr. Arup, for this great scientific feast that we are going to have today. It is a perfect conglomeration of the international speakers and our young faculty. Doctor, I would like to particularly welcome Dr. I.K. Ahmed, Dr. Thomas Hoting, and Dr. Uday Devgan, and also our young faculty, Dr. Shail Vasavada, Dr. Sayan Das, and Saurabh Patwardhan, who's from my own alma mater. And the less said about Dr. Arup Chakravarti, he's doing tremendous job as editor proceedings. He's taken it to completely a different level. And all the proceedings of the conference of the All India Ophthalmological Society are available in the most organized manner at the editor proceedings website. And I would like to again congratulate him and welcome. And I think without much ado, we should start the program.
Shail?
Yes, sir. Very good evening. First of all, my sincere thanks to the All India Ophthalmic Society and Dr. Arup sir for this wonderful opportunity. At the outset, I would like to acknowledge that we do receive research grant support from Alcon Laboratories, but has no relevance to this presentation. So this is an interesting case of a 62-year-old female who presented to us for cataract surgery in the other eye. So she had her right eye cataract surgery done elsewhere. Excellent pseudophakia, practically no refractive error, uncorrected, almost 6-12, 6-9 parts, and correcting up to 6-9, with a good single-piece hydrophobic acrylic IOL in the back. But the patient was extremely negative and extremely bitter when she presented to us. And on finding out, her only and only complaint was the negative dysphotopsia. So negative dysphotopsia typically means something that the patient doesn't see. So there are two kinds of dysphotopsias, positive and negative. So typically most patients with negative dysphotopsia tend to come up with a symptom that they feel as if their temporal vision is being blocked by an arc or a semicircle. And generally it tends to go away and decrease in majority of the patient over a few months. But this patient was already more than 9 months post-operatively in the other eye and extremely bitter. So now she has come to us for the other eye cataract surgery. and she obviously doesn't want negative dysphotopsia in this eye that she wants us to operate. So we were in a fix, you know, excellent surgery, single piece, hydrophobic, acrylic, the same IOL that we are doing day in, day out in all the patients that we operate. So there was a lot of dilemma as to how should we go ahead with this patient for the other eye, what type of IOL, what design, so on and so forth. So on reviewing the literature, there are several theories. We won't go into the mechanism of negative dysphotopsia, but the management, typically the principles have been sort of sorted out reasonably well over a period of time. And typically what most believe is that when the optic of the IOL is above the anterior capsule, so if there is no capsular covering over the optic, the chances of negative dysphotopsia are quite less. And therefore, management options have been suggested to put a three-piece IOL in the sulcus or exchange an in-the-bag IOL with the sulcus IOL, as well as reverse optic capture has been recommended as a modality of treatment. Primary treatment can be various newer kinds of IOLs like this one made by Dr. Sam Maskett, which is fixed on the anterior capsule. And there are several such modifications coming up in different IOLs. And I would also like to acknowledge now recently our own Dr. Prakhyat Roop has come up with a negative dysphotopsia ring, which can be placed in the sulcus. And I think he's going to share that in the innovative session webinar tomorrow by the All India Ophthalmic Society. But at that point of time, this was not available. So having gone through the literature, having gone through our own surgical preferences, we decided that we are probably going to do a reverse optic capture in the second eye of this patient, which means the optic remains above the capsule, whereas the haptics remain in the capsular bag. Now, the problem was then to choose which kind of IOL, because generally single piece IOLs are quite difficult to capture either the conventional way or the reverse optic capture way, because they have large optic haptic junction and bulky haptics. So three-piece IOLs are more suitable for this kind of situation, but that would mean a larger incision and probably refractive stability is also a question mark. So three-piece IOL is obviously likely to be a more preferable option. We counseled the patient, we reassured her that we will try our best. You will have to give it some time, and dysphotopsia may persist in spite of all our efforts of trying to reduce it in this eye. Now on ocular examination, what we did realize was that she had significant corneal astigmatism. Now if we do just a three-piece IOL, it's unlikely to correct the astigmatism, and therefore although she may not get negative dysphotopsia, she's going to get a poor quality of vision. So that's probably making it even worse than having a negative dysphotopsia in the eye. So again, this was a dilemma for us, whether should we consider a toric IOL, a single piece, and then try and reverse capture it, keeping in mind it has to be placed in a particular axis and so on and so forth. So we did decide that we will go as per plan A, that is to try and do a reverse capture of a toric IOL, and if we are unable to achieve it, we'll probably go to plan B. The most important step when you are prophylactically going to plan a reverse optic capture is to have a slightly superior capsulosis, because that is going to lock the IOL. This is too large. Even it's very likely that your surgical approach or your planning is going to go haywire because the optic is not going to stay captured above it. So try and make a smaller capsular excess. Of course, if the patient would have opted for it, femto would have been the ideal choice because we can control the capsular excess size. Now, having done the lens removal and the polishing of the capsule, we first decide to inject the toric IOL in the bag. So first, we want to make sure that the IOL goes and sits completely in the bag, including the haptics and the optics. So right now it is like a normal in the bag IOL, that we have placed the IOL in the bag with a good covering and the astigmatism IOL, you can see the toric IOL. Now the second thing that we need to do is that before we do a reverse capture, it's important to remove the viscoelastic from behind the eye, because once you capture it, it's almost impossible to go behind and remove the viscoelastic. So we went ahead and elastic from behind the IOL like you would normally do in it. Then we decided to do eye assistance. It's not overlaid on the microscope at this point of time. And then what we did is coelastic. So we, of course, some little bit of viscoelastic will go behind the IOL, but at least most of it is out. And we inject a cohesive sodium hyaluronate viscoelastic above the IOL. And now what we try to do is we try to, if you notice here, we are using these Lester hooks to try and prolapse the optic of the IOL in front of the anterior capsule. So we have been able to do that on this side. And then we are using again the spatula and the Lester hook here to try and prolapse the optic out of the capsular bag. So notice here the haptics are in the bag and the optic is now prolapsed out of the capsular bag. And therefore you see this this dumbbell sort of sign, which you typically see when you do a capture, even in the conventional manner. That is the anterior capsule leaflets. The optic is above the actual anterior capsular leaflets. We go ahead and then remove the viscoelastic from front of the optic to make sure that there are no residual viscoelastic. And this posterior capsule fold is also suggestive that there is no residual viscoelastic behind the IOL. And this is the patient at 6 months follow-up, no negative disc photopsia, excellent visual outcome, and a good intraocular pressure control. What you will notice is these fine striae. So these patients are more likely to get posterior capsule opacification much faster than the average eye, because the optic and the square edge of the optic is no longer going to help in preventing PCO. They are also likely to have more prolonged inflammation and uveal irritation. So they are more likely to require non-steroidal eye drops for a longer time. So treatment for negative disc photopsia, reverse optic capture can be considered. Another case of a young diabetic cataract, mainly posterior subcapsular, soft cataract, and we prefer four quadrant technique in most of these situations. And somewhere while sculpting itself, this large gap has been already created. So we have 3/4 of the nucleus inside the eye when we realize that we have a large gaping hole staring down our head. And this is the large posterior capsular rupture. We prefer pars plana approach for vitrectomy. So whenever there is a capsular rupture, you must make sure that you remove the vitreous, not only what is present or prolapsed in the anterior chamber, but also surrounding it, so that it removes the vitreous base or it creates a good scaffold all around the posterior capsular rupture. So if you notice, the vitrectomy probe is moving all around in this direction. And having done that, then we go ahead with removing the lens with phacoemulsification using, of course, very low bottle height and low parameters. And if you have done a good vitrectomy, the chances of this nucleus dropping are far less rather than if you have not done a vitrectomy. The vitreous can entangle around it and can cause a drop in the nucleus. So we were able to manage or prevent the nucleus from sinking. We were able to remove the cortex. And then we have this large area of posterior capsular rupture, and the patient was planned for a toric IOL. So the ideal option would always be put a three-piece IOL in the bag and capture it through the anterior capsular axis since it was intact. Having had some experience of reverse optic capture in negative disc photopsia, we said, let's go ahead and give it a try of trying to do a reverse optic capture even in this situation. This is more tricky because the posterior capsule is not very regularly opened like a posterior capsular axis. So here we are very gently making sure that the optic haptic junctions first goes inside the bag. And then we make sure that there is no vitreous disturbance. And having removed the viscoelastic from front, then what we go ahead is again try and do a reverse optic capture in this situation of prolapsing the optic in front of the anterior capsular axis. And once again, this is the patient at 6 months follow-up. Of course, here there will be no PCO because there is no posterior capsule in the center and no macular edema. It's important to monitor these patients for peripheral retinal events because you have done a vitrectomy and vitreous disturbance has been there. So I think reverse optic capture is a useful option to keep in a surgical armamentarium of surgeons. It is possible to be done with single piece IOL designs, including toric IOLs. Of course, it will be a lot easier with a three-piece design. And the mainstay, I think, would be to have a controlled good anterior capsular rexis opening before considering this option of reverse optic capture. So I'd like to end my presentation here, and thank you so much for the patient listening.
So it was a wonderful presentation, Shail. Now we'll just have a brief panel discussion. Dr. Haripriya and Dr. Madhu, would you like to give your comments on the cases which you just presented?
Yeah, I think they have excellent two cases, well managed. Have you tried it with the Tecnis lens? Does it behave differently from the Acrisoft IOL, considering the anterior edge is steeper? Does that help reduce the incidence of pigment dispersion?
I think probably it may, but the edge profile is pretty much still similar. It's still square. Is likely to be more pigment dispersion causing, but honestly, no experience with Tecnis single piece reverse capture to say anything else.
Yeah, and the other question I was wondering is with the toric lens, I think that was quite brave, you know, placing the haptic over the area of the lens. I think that was something which one has to take a lot more care. I think you did it very well. But you know, if you're going to have a rent over the axis where the haptic is to lie, one has to be very careful to ensure there is no, but the IOL does not pass through the rent and gets decentered or dislocated. So that's something one has to take care about.
See, Shail, I have a question. I have a question for you. How do you adjust the intraocular lens power? Because the power that you have calculated is for the optic within the capsular bag. Now it is lying anteriorly. So do you really have any fudge factor, or how do you modify the IOL power, toric IOL power in this kind of scenario?
I think he is disconnected.
I think it's frozen. Maybe the internet is.
Okay, I think any of the speakers can answer this question. I think Shail is having,
The optic's coming more anterior, so we always have to lower the IOL power. For me, the simple thing is what I call the rule of nines. If the IOL power is 0 to 9 diopters, no change. 9 to 18, drop it by a half step. 18 to 27, drop by 1 diopter. More than 27, drop by 1.5 diopters.
I think that works well for Saul, because our experience with optic captures, these lenses sit really close to the ELP for an in-the-bag lens in our experience. And so we typically don't do much change. Jason Jones published a nice little paper of reverse optic capture, and I think found on average there's about a 0.3 diopter myopic change in the myopic direction. So it's pretty small. It's less than what we see when we put in the sulcus. So for most people, I think it's probably reasonable to just really keep the power that they have. That's kind of what we've been doing. Maybe for a really small eye, a very high power, maybe you knock off half a diopter or so, but otherwise it's pretty similar in our experience.
Another issue, so for example, if you have a astigmatic refractive surprise and you have to rotate the intraocular lens, then, you know, I think it is going to be pretty difficult, isn't it? You know, because the lens is already locked in place and, you know, it is lying in front of the capsule, the rexis. And how do you rotate this lens? It is going to be very traumatic.
Leave it alone and use your excimer laser instead.
Okay. Or if you're planning it, you should do it, I think, probably within a week. I mean, we know Oshika's study tells us to do repositioning after a week, but we don't want to wait anything beyond 10 days to 2 weeks. So you want to go in earlier if you have to.
And we did not see a toric mark for the there's no corneal mark on the for the 2 week orientation.
Yeah, so then it was actually a digital overlay. When those cases were done, we didn't have the connector where the microscope overlay would also show up on the recording screen. So,
So before we go to the next topic, Dr. Uday, there will be a brief presentation by the sponsors of this particular session. Mr. Ashok, can we just make it very brief? And
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Just a quick slides. That's the thing. Thank you, sir. Thanks, I think, for the AOS and Dr. Arup Chakravarti to get associated with this webinar. I'll just have a quick video. Is the sound coming, sir?
Yes, it is continuing.
Sir.
Yeah, I would request Uday now. Uday, please get
let's do it. All right. So we're talking about a twist technique to explant a lens. You know, sometimes there is a need to take out our old IOL and replace it with a new lens. And there are many ways that have been described to do this. The traditional way is this, cutting an IOL inside the eye. And this works well. But it does require specialized instrumentation, such as these micro scissors and micro graspers. I know Ike was instrumental in getting this set out to the world, these MST style instruments. And once the IOL is cut in half or mostly in half, you can then pull out one half and then the other half will follow. And so this certainly works, but it requires, again, specialized instruments. And it takes a little bit more effort. Also, you don't have the ability to have an intact IOL at the end. Once we get the IOL out of the eye, of course, the IOL has been damaged or cut in half, et cetera. So there has to be a better way. This is a technique that I learned from Jack Chapman in Georgia. I'm going to show you this. When I first saw him do this, I was blown away. It's to twist the lens within the eye. So all you need is a spatula and straight tying forceps. So there's the IOL on top of the iris. You grab the optic, not in the center, but at the edge. Grab the edge of the optic. And this video is a resident who is doing the entire case. Now the spatula goes on top. The spatula helps to roll the IOL. And so now we twist the tying forceps, trying to do a full 360 twist. Start with your hand either pronated and supinate or do the opposite. And then once it's rolled about 360 or as much as you can, just pull it right out of the eye. And so now you can explant that single piece acrylic lens through a 2.75 millimeter incision. Here's that same case outside the eye view. So you can see twisting it and it just comes right out the incision. So it works very well. Again, spatula is important to hold the lens and help roll it, plus protect the corneal endothelium. Anterior chambers filled with viscoelastic. Once we get the lens twisted, again, we pull it right out of the eye. So it's a very useful technique that I think in your surgeries, you'll find to be a benefit. Here's now with a curved tying forceps. You see it's a little bit more awkward because the forceps aren't straight. The tips are straight, but there's a bend in the shaft. But still, even this video from a resident many years ago, you can see we can still pull the lens right out of the eye. Now the lens is intact and we can measure it or examine it or whatever else you need to do for that. And so here we go. One last time, remember, grab the optic, not in the center, grab it in the periphery, the edge. One haptic's already outside the eye. Spatula going on top. We're gonna slowly twist the forceps. And again, to get the full range, go in, for me, supinate, and then go in and pronate, and you'll get almost 360 degrees, which is enough. Now we can roll it up. We've tried this with the Alcon Acrosoft lenses, AMO Technis lenses have worked well. We've even explanted a three-piece acrylic lens with no issue at all. If you have a silicone lens, keep in mind the silicone lens is very slippery, and that's a much tougher one. So we recommend this technique for acrylic IOLs of one-piece and three-piece varieties. And again, you wanna take the lens out, put it on the cornea afterwards, just to make sure you haven't broken off a bit of the lens, the haptic, et cetera. So in that case, after we explanted that one lens, I'm just going to show you for the new lens, this patient's getting a three-piece lens. As that lens goes, it's going to be placed in the sulcus. It's first placed on top of the iris, and then it can be dialed in to position. So if you have a patient with a need for an explanting of an IOL, I encourage you to try this technique. You'll be quite impressed that it works so well. And then, Arup, we're ready for any questions, and then otherwise we can move to the second talk.
I think we'll just take up some questions. Madhu, you had any questions to be posed to Dr. Uday? Any comments to me?
Yes, sir. Very nice presentation, sir. I have a few questions. What is the exact position where we have to hold the IOL? And whether you have enlarged the incision and how much you have enlarged?
So, I think a 2.75 incision will work fine. You don't have to enlarge more than that. If you did fake it through a small 2 millimeter, 2.2 incision, you probably should enlarge it to 2.75, 2.8. You want to grab at the edge of the optic, right where a haptic is. So you saw in the video here, we pull one haptic outside the eye and then grabbing the optic at the edge. That allows us to roll it up. And Madhu, I used to do left-handed as well, but when I was a kid, my parents made me switch to right. So now when I do phaco, I can do it either way. It doesn't matter.
Yes, sir. And one more question, sir. Any effect on endothelial cell count in this technique?
So we only had one patient where we did an endothelial cell count before and after, and we found no appreciable difference. It was within a percent or two. So we're very careful to stay away from the cornea. That's the purpose of the spatula. Plus, you're doing this under the protection of viscoelastic.
Thank you, sir.
So I have a question for Uday. See, is it advisable to convert the rectangular incision into a trapezoid? You know, the internal lip is longer than the external lip of the incision, so that it is easy for you to capture the lens within the tunnel without traumatizing the tunnel too much before you pull it out.
I think that's reasonable. You can try that. And most of these videos, the residents are using a 2.75 incision to begin with. And so we just open the existing incision, phaco incision. If you have a clear corneal incision that's totally avascular, you'll find that you can open it even a year later. If the original incision has hit the limbal vessels, then it may be requiring an additional cut. The trapezoidal can be done, but I don't do it. You don't need to for this.
So when you rotate the lens, is there any possibility of damage to the underlying iris tissue, particularly if it is a very friable iris and it's a constricted pupil?
It depends on the case, but I'm sure that's a possibility. But again, we've probably done about 8 or 10 of these and had no issues.
Any questions from any of the speakers, panelists?
Hey, Uday, this is Tom Oding. Which way are you turning it? You're turning it towards your second instrument or towards the iris?
So honestly, it doesn't make too much of a difference, but we're holding the IOL and we're turning it so that the natural tendency of the optic is to go up against your spatula. I don't want to push it down into the iris.
That makes sense. Yeah, I think it's really slick. Have you tried there was a technique that Bonnie Henderson published where you just pulled on the SNWFs to the wound and then you went across with a hook and just sort of buckled it to get it to start. And I tried that a few times and found it difficult. I think this is really slick. And the other thing that's cool.
Yeah, go ahead.
I said the other thing that's really cool is sometimes you don't have, Ike's instruments in that OR, or they're not ready, or one of your colleagues has already used them all up for the day. And so I think this is really slick, and I appreciate it.
Cool, thank you.
Sayan, you wanted something to say? Sayan, did you have something to say?
You have to unmute yourself, my friend.
You have to unmute, sir.
Yeah, Sayan, you're muted.
Sorry for that. Am I audible now?
Yes,
you're good.
Yes, so what should be the status of the pupil when the IOL is coming out? Would you like to dilate the patient preoperatively?
Doesn't matter.
Okay. No.
Yeah, I think I'm just saying that there could be an issue if you have a large rind and the chance of vitreous prolapse would be higher if you had a large pupil. That probably is the only thing you'll have to think of. But I agree with Tom. It was a beautiful technique, and we're looking forward to trying it.
Exactly.
So, Arup, let's move forward. I want to keep you on track.
Thank you. So we'll go to the next case.
So this is a very fun one for me. This is, again, I'm with my residents at a free teaching hospital. We call a county hospital in the U.S. So the patients are getting free surgery, and the resident does it. But we don't have a lot of fancy instruments. There is no excimer laser at the teaching hospital. We don't have the micro forceps that Ike loves to use. We don't have all these toys. So we gotta learn to be creative. Sometimes we don't even have a toric lens for some of the patients. So what we're doing is paired phaco incisions to treat astigmatism. And this is not a new idea. The pro is it's easy, there's no other instruments, fast, efficient, low cost. The cons, it's only about a diopter of astigmatism. And there are two potential leak sites because you have two incisions. And there can be a variable response depending on how you make the incision and also the patient's age and the corneal position. All these things, of course, have an effect. So there's a 20-year history of paired phaco incisions. And you see in the past, these were all greater than 3 millimeters. And they caused 1 to 2 diopters of flattening. Remember, a superior incision that's identical will have more astigmatic flattening than a temporal incision. And this is an important thing to remember. So here, standard phaco incision, sitting temporally or superior, whatever your preference is, finish the case. Now with the eye full of viscoelastic, and the IOL is protecting the bag, a little more viscoelastic in fact. Now with this eye full of viscoelastic, we're gonna make an opposite phaco incision. Full thickness, the same tunnel length, the same design incision on the opposite side. And so when you make this incision, now you have more flattening. Against the rule, maybe you'll get about a half diopter flattening with one incision. But if I have two incisions, I can almost double that. I can get up to a diopter of flattening. So depending on where the effect is, the position is, you'll change the effect. So here now is a sitting superiorly one. So we're sitting superiorly doing the phaco incision, and that looks like a pretty nice incision. End of the case, IOLs in the bag, more viscoelastic going in the eye. And now we're gonna make an opposite incision. So this is operating at about the 90 degree meridian. So this is for with the rule astigmatism in this patient. And so we make the same incision opposite side. You can go all the way in like this, or you can go partially in to titrate the effect. If I just have the one phaco incision superiorly, it's probably a half diopter or so of corneal flattening, maybe a little bit more. But if I have a paired incision now, I can get a solid diopter, maybe even a little bit more of astigmatic treatment just from the phaco incisions. So you can also shift your hand to access different meridians. Like I was saying to Madhu, I can do left hand or right hand. So here is right handed and we're operating at about the 75 degree meridian. The ink mark there is 90 degrees. At the end of the case, we switch hands. This is now my left hand and doing the opposite incision. If you're a young ophthalmologist in training, I encourage you use both hands. You should be eating food and brushing your teeth and doing things with your left hand to improve that dexterity. Shave your face, do whatever you do, use both hands. Here's the end of the case. Make sure both incisions seal well. Now we can also do it in a private surgery center. This is using a diamond keratome in a private surgery center. So there's the main incision temporally at about the 15 degree mark. And then here at the end of the case is another one. So it doesn't just have to be the steel blades, you can use diamond. Here's the effect we found. We found that for a paired against the rule incision, we had about 0.7 diopters on average of flattening. And for with the rule, we had about a diopter's worth. So you can see there's quite an improvement there. There is a bit of variable range, as you can see from those error bars, but this tends to be a pretty useful technique, especially if you're young and in your training. And this will even work if you have to put a sulcus lens in, or you do a three-piece lens, you don't have a toric lens, your capsule bag broke, you did an anterior vitrectomy, it's all okay. Do this at the end of the case, again, when the IOL is already in the bag and the anterior chamber is filled with viscoelastic. Remember, a wider incision will have more effect than a narrower incision. So 2.8 will have more effect. A more central incision within the clear cornea will have more of an effect than if you're at the limbal vessels. A shorter tunnel length, again, more effect, and the incision may not seal as well. Whereas a longer tunnel length will have a little bit less effect, but it will seal better. If you have more than a diopter of astigmatism, of course, use a toric lens. That makes the most sense. It's the most accurate. This is not as accurate as a toric lens, but there's a big advantage. This is easy and it's free and requires no extra instrumentation. So again, starting your case with the phaco incision on the steep axis, fast forward to the end, IOL's in the bag, and there's the opposite incision still on that same axis on the 180 degrees away. And you can do full thickness here. You can go a little shy of full thickness if you need to. Here's a good example. There's a before and after. A 1.25 of astigmatism with the rule. Afterwards, 1/4 of astigmatism. And look at the refractive error from minus 850 going to Plano and just a -1/4 of sill. Beautiful result for this patient. And this is using just those full thickness incisions. So again, bottom line to remember, for 2.8 incisions, against the rules about 0.7 of flattening, with the rules about a diopter flattening. And I think this is something that any surgeon, no matter what your level of training, you can incorporate this into your practice. Thank you, Arup.
A wonderful presentation, Uday. And anybody would like to add something or ask questions to Uday about the technique you just described? Uday, out of 10 patients with astigmatism up to less than one diopter, how many of these cases you employ limbal relaxing incision or the paired clear corneal opposite clear corneal incision for the numbers?
So I tend to, in my own practice, I'd rather do a limbal relaxed incision using a diamond, appropriate depth, and you know, measure the pachymetry ahead of time. I think I'm more accurate with that. But when we're at our free teaching hospital, we don't have diamond blades. We don't have a way of doing an LRI other than the disposable LRI blades. And we find that this is probably easier for the residents and a little bit more forgiving. So in my private practice, I rarely use this technique, but with the residents, we use it every week.
What is the predictability and the consistency of the outcomes? I mean, because Warren Hill, let's say they have taught us, you know, the surgical induced astigmatism actually is all over the place. Very difficult to predict the magnitude as well as the meridian. And now
for
we...
Sure. The key there, you can't exactly, you're going to change the magnitude in the meridian if you're using a toric lens and you're placing your incision off axis. So this is one of the benefits here. It's super forgiving. You're operating on the steep axis. And even if you're 5 or 10 degrees away, you still have an appreciable benefit for it. Look, if you have a diopter or more of astigmatism, you're better off with a toric lens. If you have less and you have a need, this is a very useful technique. There is a variable curve we talked about in the video. Position of the incision, the width of incision, the tunnel length of the incision, the patient's age, corneal white to white, all these things will affect it, of course. But try this in your own hands, I bet you'll be surprised. And it's not a new idea. This has been published 20, 30 years ago.
Exactly. Yeah. So anybody wants to comment on that? Yes, Aurav?
I think what Dr. Uday has just shown, both the things are extremely useful for a young surgeon who wants to convert his practice to a premium IOL practice. Because when I started off, first thing I had doubt in mind, what if I had to explant a premium IOL? Am I good in that? So I think if you are good in explanting IOL, you are much more confident in implanting a premium IOL. That is one thing. And second thing about the opposite clear corneal incision, I use them a lot because of the basic thing that it doesn't cost anything. But then you become mindful of the patient's astigmatism. And that's very important for, again, premium IOL practice, because you want to leave the patient with the minimum possible astigmatism. I think the first thing to start is this opposite clear corneal incision, and then you can move on to LRI and toric IOLs as well. I think both these tricks are really, really useful for young surgeons.
I'll have some comments from Ike and Tom before we move on to the next topic about what do you do and what is your opinion on this?
I think Uday presented it very well. I think it's good to have a number of tricks up your sleeve, and I think you know, the twist technique is a nice approach. So well done. And opposite incisions, I think as Uday said, there's a long history of it, and you're giving some really good pearls. I think you know, what I would suggest you do, Uday, though, you should make your incisions before you start the case, because then you can do half the cataract with your right hand and half the cataract with your left hand through two different incisions. That's what you should be doing.
I think it's great, Uday. I love the way you're thinking. You know, the ironic thing for us is that at our VA hospital, we actually have more gadgets than we do at our university hospital. And so we find ourselves easier. It's easier to get torics. It's easier to get diamond blades and stuff. Have you ever had the situation where one of those incisions leaked and you regretted doing it?
We have had a resin case for sure, where we had a leak of that opposite incision. But we've also had resin cases where you're doing a standard phaco with one incision and that leaks too. So luckily we know how to fix that.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so we'll move on to the next topic then. Yeah, so friends, you know, I always feel that the hydro steps, whether it is a cortical cleaving hydro dissection or hydro delineation, it's an unsung procedure in phacoemulsification. It lacks the glamour of, you know, what Uday had just shown, you know, cutting the lenses, and what Ike is going to show about Rexis in very difficult situations, or a nucleus getting chopped into multiple places. But it plays a very, very important role in phacoemulsification. Many a time when I have a complication and I trace back what went wrong, I often stumble at this step, hydro steps, which was not done properly. On the other hand, there could be complications of cortical hydro dissection, particularly cortical cleaving hydro dissection. And I'm going to talk to you about a particular complication, the pupillary snap, what exactly it is, how you appreciate it, and then if you don't take precautionary measures or remedial measures, what could be the sequelae. And finally, I'll wrap up by talking about how to avoid this complication. Now, this patient was in his mid-60s. You know, it was not a very difficult cataract and very good rexis, adequately sized, and hydro dissection is going on. I would advise you not to blink here. So as the nucleus is balloted, you know, I let out the fluid egress occurs from the opposite pole. At this point, when the reverse migration of fluid is happening, when the hydro dissection is happening from the other side, if you see carefully here, the fluid has gone and there is a pupillary snap. At this particular moment, the pupil comes down a little bit and you can see a little bit of deepening that happens of the posterior chamber in that area. So fortunately, you know, I picked it up and I modified my phaco techniques. I did a phaco and everything went off fine. So here you can see before the aisle implantation on the nasal side, there's a huge posterior capsular rim and there's a little bit of lens matter debris on the anterior vitreous. So patient was followed up for some time and I really couldn't figure out what went wrong here. You know, my rexis was adequately sized. It was not a very elderly patient that the posterior capsule would be thin and compromised. I'll be showing you subsequently that, you know, I always burp the incisions of the anterior chamber is evacuated of the OVD to a certain extent. If I've used Helon 5, Helon GV or Viscote, the nucleus is, the capsular bag is decompressed after balloting the nucleus. And none of these cases had a contraindication for hydro dissection. And what saved the day for me was I was alert and I knew a pupillary snap had occurred. And I took remedial measures. Now, this was another case, this patient had undergone vitrectomy elsewhere, had rapid opacification of the lens. About a month later, patient came to me, and I didn't have the records of the patient available with me. So when I performed a cortical cleaving hydro dissection, you see a classical pupillary snap sign. Now, this particular patient had a lot of comorbidity, so I didn't want to continue with phacoemulsification. So I converted into a small incision cataract surgery technique in this particular patient. This patient, of course, had a predisposing factor for the PCLN to happen during cortical cleaving hydro dissection. So the pupil snap was first described by Ronald Yeo, a good friend of mine from Singapore, in a letter to editor BJO published in 1996, where they had three cases. In one of the three cases, he had hydrodissected from the side pole. This is something which you don't do at all. We teach our residents not to do hydrodissection from the side pore. And he documented that in all the three cases, pupillary snap was recognized when there was sudden reduction in the size of the pupil to the extent of 30%. And in all these cases, he had to convert to a non-phaco technique. 6 years down the line, this was again confirmed by another study from Singapore. So basically for the youngsters here, I'd like to tell you is when you perform a cortical cleaving hydrodissection, fluid accumulates behind the nucleus in front of the posterior capsule. There are capsular cortical adhesions in the equator. So as the pressure builds up, either these adhesions break because you press on the nucleus, on the tip of the nucleus, and the fluid sort of comes out from the opposite area of the capsular axis. And if that is not done, there is tremendous buildup of pressure here, and then you have a posterior capsular rent. And this is actually the genesis of a pupillary snap sign. Now, this is one case I'm going to show you where I did not diagnose that occurrence of pupillary snap in the right moment. And let's see what happened. This was again a man in his mid-50s, multi-system illness. He was on dialysis. He had received multiple injections, I think 7 or 8 injections of intravitreal bevacizumab. And it is a grade 4 cataract. I mean, this is something which we routinely do. So Rexis went off pretty uneventfully, as you see here. It is about 5 millimeters in size, and cortical cleaving hydrodissection is going to take place. I've already let out some OVD from inside the eye, so the eye is not really hard. With the Chang cannula, please don't blink. And you know, I just took it for granted, and I did a cortical cleaving hydrodissection. I missed its sign, but what I realized was the eye had become pretty little hard. So I remembered about the publication from Singapore where, you know, too much of fluid accumulation can result in increase in intraocular pressure, iris prolapse can happen. So I thought I was doing it a similar situation. I didn't think about other causes of hardening or intraoperative hardening of the eye, like supracoroidal hemorrhage, because the patient had absolutely no pain. And to a certain extent, when I tried to ballot the nucleus, tried to rotate the nucleus, the intraocular pressure did come down, but it was not really soft. So I just went ahead with phacoemulsification. And since it was a grade 4 cataract, I thought I'll debulk the nucleus to a certain extent and perform all the maneuvers in front of the posterior capsule. At this stage itself, I could realize that there was a nucleus tilt that was happening. And this was pretty ominous, but somehow I felt that I would be able to remove most of the nucleus from the anterior root by phacoemulsification. But I was actually quite wrong in making that assumption. And you find here that the nucleus doesn't rotate well. So, we are dealing with a large area of posterior capsular rent. And the inevitable happens. You know, though you remove a big chunk of the nucleus, but I think about 25% of the nucleus dives down into the posterior segment. By that time, the patient was quite unwell. You know, he was on dialysis. He had pulmonary edema. So I could not complete the surgery in the same sitting. So I injected a dispersive OVD into the anterior chamber. I realized that I will just mop up the anterior segment, remove the vitreous, remove as much of cortex as possible. And then patient will be called back on another day for the posterior segment component of the surgery, where through the pars plana, using a phragmatome, lens fragmentation would be done. And that was my game plan. So patient came back after 3 days after having dialysis. And then by that time, the eye looks very, very quiet, as you'll see later on. Whenever there's a PC dent, we invariably put a suture, close the incision, main incision. At times, I've also closed the side port incisions. And this is how the patient looked like on the third post-op day when we're taking him up for definitive surgery, eye implantation. So with the fragmentome, the lens matter was removed. By that time, the pupil had become small, so I had to use iris hooks to see the architecture of the capsular bag, where exactly the rexis margin is located. And I used a 3-piece hydrophobic acrylic lens, a sensor lens, which was injected into the leading haptic was injected into the ciliary sulcus. So one has to be careful here, because if the dent is large, and if you don't handle the situation well, it's quite possible that the leading haptic may go through the area of the PCRM, and you will have the whole lens dislocating into the posterior segment. So that fortunately was avoided by this technique. And this is the best technique for implanting the trailing haptic. Don't try to dial it in. And patient did pretty well for a couple of months after the surgery. He is no more. So basically here, if I had diagnosed pupillary snap at the right time, I could have avoided this complication. So whenever we have eye becoming hard during surgery, in this particular case, of course, you know, there's a capsular block syndrome and a PCRN that happened. But we must think in terms of infusion misdirection syndrome, acute intraoperative rock hard eye syndrome, suprachoroidal hemorrhage, suprachoroidal effusion. And these situations will have, you know, the suprachoroidal hemorrhage, the intraocular pressure will be high, the patient will have pain. And if it is not a mature cataract, not an advanced cataract, what you saw here, you will see, you know, the red reflex gradually going away. And best, the only option that situation would be to close the incision and take up the patient after a couple of weeks, along with the posterior segment surgeon. So basically, what I'd like to tell you that, so how do we avoid it? You know, so this is again for the youngsters. Always use a plastic syringe for performing hydrodissection. I use the smallest syringe that is available. Use BSS or Oculan, that is lignocaine hydrochloride. I use either the Chang cannula or the Akahoshi cannula. And you could use any 25 to 28 gauge cannula, the Rycroft cannula, which comes with the OVDs. That is also good enough. And if your rexis is small, as you see here, at the end of the rexis, I found my, you know, it was quite small sized. And if I perform a hydrocortical cleaving hydrodissection at this stage, it's quite possible that there'll be tremendous buildup of pressure behind the nucleus and I'll have a PC dent. So I decided to perform a two-stage rexis at this stage itself. So make sure that you don't have a rexis which is less than 4 millimeters, particularly when you're dealing with patients in the advanced age group or patients with a very hard cataract, particularly female patients, where the posterior capsule is likely to be thin. So I enlarged the rexis to about 5 millimeters and went and performed a hydrodissection. So again, for the youngsters, you see the fluid wave traversing posteriorly and then stop at that stage. You decompress the capsular bag by tipping at the nucleus, this area. So there is flow of fluid, the pent-up fluid from the equatorial area comes out, and then you do a two-point cortical cleaving hydrodissection, and you and then the nucleus may rotate or may not rotate, but if I've seen the fluid wave, more often than not, it is, you know, it tells you that it is a complete cortical cleaving hydrodissection that has taken place. In certain situations, the nucleus doesn't rotate, and there are maneuvers to take care of it. I'm not going into the details. This is something I would like to really emphasize. Particularly, it is a very hard cataract, though you have a very good red reflex. But in this kind of situation, you must burp out the OVD from inside the anterior chamber, because I always use a soft shell technique. So viscoat is always there in the anterior chamber. So you need to decompress the anterior chamber, and then only you should perform a cortical cleaving hydrodissection in this kind of scenario. And make sure that there is no air bubbles. I have had situations which I have not recorded, where air bubble was injected during cortical cleaving hydrodissection, and that had resulted in trauma to the posterior capsule. And that, of course, you know, you have to be very careful. And I cannot, you know, resist the temptation to show you this case. This is a case with capsular cortical adhesions. These are seen in the central areas, but in certain situations, they'll be located in the peripheral area. So even if you dilate the pupil, you won't see them. They'll be in the equatorial area. And I feel that if these patients come at a later stage when the cataract has advanced, they become fibrotic plaques. And Deepak Megur is going to show you some cases where, you know, these plaques are going to be managed. So here, whenever I perform a cortical cleaving hydrodissection, the moment I see a lens milk, that I know that I'm dealing with adhesions in the peripheral area. So I'll be extra careful and make sure the hydrodissection proceeds very carefully, very gently, very meticulously, and very completely before I try to rotate the nucleus. This is something which I think IK had presented, published in one of the journals. This was a rexis. I had certain difficulties. You know, there are a lot of annoying reflexes on the nasal side. So I was not really sure what was happening. And the rexis, I thought went up pretty well. I completed it. But when hydrodissection happens, I realized that there was a snap here. There was a weak point in the capsular rexis margin here. And you'll see here that particular weak point, it enlarged. So there the rexis discontinuity and there are two flaps. You know, this is one flap and this is another flap going to the periphery. So whenever you are dealing with a rexus weakness, there is a angle, there is a V, or there is a point in the rexus, not as a curvilinear one. You got to be very, very careful while performing cortical cleaving hydrodissection. There are certain situations where you should not do it. Whenever you suspect a pre-existing posterior capsular rent or a weak posterior capsule, as in these situations where there's a posterior polar cataract, traumatic cataract with intraocular glass, double capsular perforation, post-vitrectomy cataracts, particularly when the cataract has progressed very rapidly immediately after the vitrectomy. So friends, what I'd like to take home points from my presentation would be, make sure that you are aware of all the contraindications for cortical cleaving hydrodissection. Don't perform this if those conditions exist. Never hydrodissect through the side port. Always burp the incision wound for the OVD, to let out the OVD and decompress the anterior chamber. Decompress the capsular bag. Do not allow too much of pressure to build up within the capsular bag. Always watch out for pupillary snap. So whenever I hydrodissect, I never blink, you know, because this thing happens within a fraction of a second. And if you miss it, and if you proceed without modifying your steps, you are in for trouble. For soft cataracts, some people do hydrodelineation. I don't do it. And even if you follow the proper guidelines, these complications, which may be associated with hydrodissection, can be avoided. So this is what I wanted to talk to you about my presentation. So this is it. If anybody wants to contribute something, want to add something, most welcome. And then Ike takes over on his talk on capsular rexus tricks. Anybody wants to comment something?
Yeah, Arup, I just wanted to say that this problem has gotten worse for us with the increase in intravitreal injections. I think that one case you shouldn't blame yourself, because likely the posterior capsule was injured by one of those past injections. And now when we're faced with patients that have had multiple intravitreal injections, this should come to mind. You should worry about the possibility of some capsular injury that is going to make it more likely that that you end up with your pupillary snap sign. There was a study out of England, there was a study out of Duke that showed the increase is about 3 times. You're more likely to have capsular injury when patients have had a lot of intravitreal injections. I think the real dilemma we face is, do we treat all of those patients that have had a lot of vitreal injections like a posterior polar, or do we still sort of go forward and assume that everything's okay? And that's been the dilemma for me. I've had 2 of these patients, exactly like the one you showed, did a perfectly reasonable hydrodissection, and the lens went posterior. And these people had a lot of injections. So I just want everyone to be aware of patients that have had a lot of injections. Look carefully for evidence of capsular injury. And then if you do see that, you definitely need to change your strategy and treat it like a posterior polar cataract. The ones that are tricky are the ones that don't show that evidence, and you're still not really sure how to modify your therapy. But I'm really glad you brought this up. I think hydrodissection is underrated, and thank you for sharing your tips.
Thank you, Tom, for the very constructive comments, very interesting comments. Ike, you're ready with the talk? Haripriya, I wanted
thing to add. So in patients, when we do surgery on patients who have had vitrectomy and injections, I always check to see when the surgery was done or when the last injection was given. So if it's typically within a month, those patients have a very high chance of having a posterior capsule rupture. They probably had a lens touch. And again, most of these cataracts are complete. So obviously that would have been a combined surgery to begin with. So the history of the prior surgery or injection is one useful aspect. And I can be almost certain that there was a lens touch if it's within 4 to 6 weeks before the cataract surgery.
Exactly, yeah. So over to Ike, the field is yours.
Well, thank you, Arup, again. Thank you. And thank you to all my Indian colleagues in AIOS and all the folks that are doing this great work. You guys always do things really big. And of course, this is my kind of my homeland, so it's always a little closer to my heart. And thanks, Arup, for all the education that you do at all the meetings and virtually as well. So these are my presentation slides here. I will talk about capsular rexus tricks. These are my disclosures. And so really, my presentation can be long or short. This is really a very simple presentation. I can basically just present this video, which is femtolaser capsulotomy. And then my presentation is over. So Arup, we have 20 more minutes. You have to open the floor for discussion. But really, there's much more to capsulotomy than femtorexus. And of course, you know, femto technology is still being discussed and debated. You know, I have done many femto capsulotomies. We are still debating the value of femto versus non-femto, and I won't get into that. But I think the mastery of basics and advanced capsulorhesis techniques is critical for any phaco surgeon. And I will try to go through some basics and some advanced tricks when it comes to doing capsulotomies and capsulorhesis in routine and advanced cases. And I really think that this is, part of the procedure that I think, you know, we always talk to the residents and fellows about being at one with the eye. You feel like you're at one with the eye. And I think when you do the capsulorhesis, you get a real feel for how the case is going to go. And it gives us a qualitative assessment as far as the capsule, as far as the zonules. And I think it's very valuable. We also know that for many of you, it can be difficult. It can cause autonomic dysfunction when you think about a capsulorhesis or even when you're having to deal with a tough one. So I hope these pros will help you. Let's remember the capsule anatomy, this type 4 collagen, which is the thickest basement membrane in the body, which is, typically about 14 to 20 microns in the anterior extent of it is what we are talking about here. Remember that the mechanical properties of the capsule changes as we get older. We lose the elasticity as we get older, which can be plus and minus. Of course, in young patients who are very elastic capsules, it can be very challenging, of course, for the capsule to want to run out. Also remember, as we get older, there's more convexity of the anterior lens. This changes the vector forces of the capsulorhesis. We need to consider this, of course, when we do our capsulorhesis because we use vector forces. It's important, of course, to always remember a few principles and pros as I've listed here. You know, we pressurize the eye. We always remember to use the incision as a fulcrum. We want to be deliberate in our motions and understanding the physics of what we do here. We all know, I think, the value of doing a good capsulotomy and a capsulorhesis, I think, is quite evident in terms of the importance for safety, ELP, positioning of the lens, reduction of PCO. And as was mentioned earlier, if the lens has to be removed, it is a little easier if there's anterior capsule overlap to lift off the capsule off the lens. What we want to see is a nice capsulotomy present with good overlap when you see the edge of the IOL beyond the capsular edge. So remember, viscoelastics are really important. They pressurize the eye. They help to counteract the tendency to run out. But also we need to be mindful that we don't want to overinflate the eye either. So it's always a steady balance. I think the one weapon that we all use in our surgeries that's most important for me is the capsulorhesis forceps. And although many do needle capsulorhesis, I think the control with a forceps, particularly in complicated cases, I think is optimal. So nothing wrong with learning needle and doing needle capsulorhesis, but I prefer a capsulorhesis forceps. And you know, the cross-section forceps, I think, have some value in terms of you can see the difference. And these can go through a 2-millimeter incision. And they have the advantage of this in working through smaller spaces and less gaping of the incision. You see the difference with the regular standard capsulorhesis forceps. And I think this is, you see the obvious differences here. So cross-action are helpful, and this is typically what we do. Of course, a microforcep is also very handy as well for folks to use as well. Remember the difference between shearing and stretching. We typically use shearing approaches where the force is at the plane of the capsule, and it's directed parallel. And we take advantage, of course, with the smoothness of this tear, and it's very controlled. However, it doesn't allow for any abrupt changes in direction. And this is where stretching basically can help to direct the forces perpendicular to the direction of where we want to tear. When we do this stretching technique, some people call it ripping, other things, I think these are the good terms to use, we can really adjust the positioning of the capsulorhesis. These figures from Barry Seibel very nicely show the importance of vectors. You see the vector forces and the torquing of the shearing movements of the hands, depending on the capsular flap. It's, for those that are learning, it's good to unfold the capsular flap completely, keep it unfolded, and then tear close to the surface of the anterior capsule for better control. When the capsulorhesis is bunched up like on the bottom right, it's less controlled. And remember, if the capsulorhesis is running out, we need to change the direction of our vector. You see, for example, in red, we will grab the flap and tear more centrally, which will cause a tear to come in more. So always remember, vector forces are important. This is kind of a standard capsulorhesis. I have a moderately sharp tip capsule access forceps. We make an incision in the central, and then we grab one edge of the capsule, and then we tear toward a direction. This case is going to be clockwise. And again, notice how we're using a shearing technique. I don't totally unfold the flap because I've gotten comfort in doing this, but it is helpful to unfold if you're not sure. And re-grasp, again, you see about maybe a millimeter to 2 millimeters from the apex of the tear. Continue the rexus. And if you look at the rexus, when we tear the rexus with shearing, you can actually see that the forceps itself is basically outlining the direction of where we're going. And so actually, in a usual case, you can see how the rexus is being propagated, and the forceps are actually following the same contour of where the rexus is going to tear. And this is a good way to kind of approximate the vector required. You can see the forceps are actually tracing the outline of where that tear will go. Frequent re-grasping is helpful. I'll show another case, and I want you to look in this case. I want you to look particularly at the incision here, and just look how the forceps are being used with the incision being as a fulcrum, avoiding the turning. Very, very commonly with beginners, a lot of tension is placed on the incision, and the eye is moving around, and the viscoelastic is escaping, and the tear is not as controlled. So you can see how the forceps are torqued in the incision, are rotated in the incision as a fulcrum. And again, you can see how the tear is being followed along to outline the rexus direction. You can see the forceps are basically leading the tear in a shearing fashion. And those are some good approaches. We do have digital markerless systems, which also are nice and handy. You can see here, we've marked the cornea as well in this case. So there are many different, imprints you can leave on the cornea with marking tools that can be helpful to guide the tear. And also in this case, you can see we're also using a digital overlay system here. And this also can provide some guidance in terms of sizing as well, which is another nice tool. Is a necessity? No, not a necessity, but it's just something that some find it useful to have a bit of a guide and its image overlay in doing it this manner. Well, the rexus roundout, of course, is something we all have to be mindful of. And there are certain eyes at risk. Small eyes, of course, is one of the risk factors as well. We want to make sure we pressurize the eye very well in these cases. We need to change the vector force, and we need to be comfortable to convert to a stretching tear. In some cases, we have to actually restart the rexus and reconnect it if it really runs out. The again, principles here are converting from a shearing to a stretching technique. And Brian Little has published a nice paper many years ago. And this video will just show the tear started here. And as the tear is propagated to the nasal side, you'll see that the tear is starting to run out. You can see it's okay here, but the surgeon is losing a bit of control here. It's running out a bit farther. It's still salvageable. And this is where the surgeon should have changed the vector. But you can see how the tear is running out closer to the iris here. Well, what do we do here? Well, again, Brian Little has published some nice articles. These are some of our examples here. The same case here, the tear is going. The green arrow is the direction of your vector of the forceps. And look what's happened, it's run out. Now, one can stop and put more viscoelastic in. If you put more viscoelastic in, don't put it centrally, put it peripherally. If you put the viscoelastic centrally, it can cause a tear to run out. This is an important pro for beginners. Put it in the periphery here. And then, and in fact, you can even avoid this if you actually convert to a stretch right away. Unfold the flap completely. Grab the flap about a millimeter and a half from the apex of the tear. And then pull the flap 90 degrees to the direction you wish to change. So if you want the direction to change this way, you will pull the flap in a 90 degree direction. So it doesn't mean to the center. It means 90 degrees to the direction we want it to tear. Now the tear has been redirected. We can then again back and fold the capsular rexus back and continue along with the capsular rexus as we should. Here's just to show the video again. The capsular rexus is tearing out. You can see it's running out to the pupil edge. Unfold the flap, even before viscoelastic, you can do it right on the fly. Grab about a millimeter and a half from the apex and then pull 90 degrees to the direction we want to go. We want to go this direction. We're gonna pull in this 90 degrees direction, and you can see a little bit of tension there. Sometimes you have to really give it a jerk and you continue along with the capsular rexus. It's just a simple way to save it. And we should all be comfortable with the stretching approaches. So another example of a more intravascular lens, you can see the capsular rexus is starting off okay. Probably would have been useful to maybe start a bit smaller. And as we get to the subincisional area, you'll see the rexus is starting to run out. It's running out here. Oh, it's really running out here. We need to stop. We need to basically unfold the capsule and then pull 90 degrees away. And now we can see we redirect it. I'll just show you again. It just happens very quickly here. And rather than stopping, injecting viscoelastic, we're just going to convert to a stretch, grab, pull 90 degrees to the direction of the flap you want to tear it, and there you have it back in position there. So keep in mind this approach here. This is a surgeon starting capsular exercise. You can see it's starting off slow. The rexus is continuing along here. And as we get off to the, about 3/4 of completion, the rexus is running out. You can see how it's run out here. I'm pointing to the arrow here. It's really run out under the anterior capsule. The surgeon is trying to redirect it, but really you need to grab. See, my cannula is pointing to where we should grab about 2 millimeters or 1.5 millimeters from the apex, pull to the center very quickly and redirect it. And there you have the rexus has been redirected there nicely as it was running out there. So again, another approach there as well. This example here, the rexus is running out and is too far run out. So we're just showing the rexus is started. It's run out really far in the periphery there. Really, you cannot see it anymore. And it was felt that we could not redirect it. In this case, what one can do, there it is. It's way out past the pupil margin. It's running out probably to the equator here. In these cases here, we can restart the rexus from the initiation site and making a little cut in the capsule where the rexus was initiated, again, with a 27-gauge needle in this case, we create a little flap. This flap is then grasped, and then the capsular rexus is rejoined to where it ran out. It's helpful to let it run out a little bit as it's going toward the area of runout to allow it to sort of meet to the apex of where it ran out. But sometimes we have to resort to these situations here to allow the capsular rexus to continue. Or one can convert to a can opener, of course, as well. So to cut and then reconnect is another option as well. This is an example here where the surgeon started the capsular rexus and the rexus is running out here. You can see subincisionally, it's really, really far in the periphery here. And so the surgeon, we had to stop and then cut. See, look how far it's run out, really far out into the periphery here. So sometime making another incision and using a pair of micro scissors can be used to amputate the flap. And here we're basically cutting with the scissors and amputating the flap where it's run out. And so we have a discontinuous capsular exit. You see where it's run out there. And the problem when we do this is that if we allow the chamber to shallow in some cases, as you'll see here, look what happens in this case. Everything's intact so far, but watch very closely. And there the rexus is wrapped around into the posterior capsule. So there's a risk when we cut the capsular rexus where it's weak and it can run out, where we see this happening. And so whenever we see a discontinuous rexus, there are important principles to remember. It's another example here where the capsular rexus has been initiated. You can see it's running out toward the periphery here. And the surgeon is unable to save it. You see it's run out way in the periphery here, right there. And even using the little maneuver to try to stretch the capsule isn't enough. So we'll have to cut it and amputate it. In these cases here, it's important that we have certain principles that we have when we manage these cases. The most important thing for me is to make sure the chamber doesn't shallow. The chamber shallows, then the capsular rexus may want to run out. And of course, we avoid traction in the area of where it's running out, and all these important principles are there and present important. Small pupil rexus, well, I think it's pretty straightforward. You know what? Use a Maligan ring. It really is a nice way to get pupils enlarged. The other option, of course, is to use iris hooks to help to expose and reveal the capsule. In this case, you can see it's a small bag. And in these cases here, we have to make a small capsular rexus. Otherwise, of course, we lose the anterior capsule shelf. But you can see the benefit of having really good exposure with iris hooks that can be really helpful here. We do also look at doing small pupil rexus without using any pupillary guides. And I call this, quote, under the covers. What I mean by that is basically we're doing the capsular rexus under the iris. This is a bit of a higher order skill. What we're really looking at is observing the behavior of the flap. And as we tear the flap, as you see here, if the flap is moving nicely without any stria, then we can be assured the rexus is basically continuing in a proper fashion. And that gives us a bit of assurance. Now, the use of a Kuglin hook can be useful as well, but it does give us an advantage of not having to manipulate the iris excessively. Again, it's no problem to use iris hooks and Maligan rings, but I think if you're comfortable doing it without it, it's nice to not have to be reliant on this. And here, actually, we have good visibility. We can see the tear occurring, and we can actually follow the tear as it tears, we know that the capsular rexus will be well positioned as we get more comfortable and we get more experience, And I think that doing it without any aids is something that can be helpful and useful. When we have an intermittent lens, of course, we know the risk of capsule runout is higher because of the pressurization of the capsular bag. TriPan Blue is put in. And what's very important here is to use a good super viscous agent. We typically use Helon 5 to really pressurize the eye to flatten the capsule. One pearl that many have talked about, which is nice, is using a 25-gauge needle to aspirate the lens material upon the initial puncture of the anterior capsule. This will decompress the capsular bag, and blotting the nucleus back also allows for fluid to come around. And then we can continue along with our rexus here. So doing the initiation of the capsular rexus along with aspiration, I think, is a nice way to allow us to, you know, do this rexus without it running out, which of course is the risk. These still may run out, so it's good to make it a bit on the smaller side if you're not sure. And we can see that the rexus is nicely formed. Well, what about capsular folds like this case here? You can see on the OCT, we can see significant capsular folds and thickening of the capsule in this trauma case. And we see with Vision Blue, we see these capsular folds. It is very difficult, like you see here, to get a good capsulotomy. We tried to decenter it, but I had to cut it with a scissor. And I think that's something that we have to always be aware of. These trauma cases can be very difficult. Again, TriPan Blue is helpful. We'll put some triamcinolone to evaluate the vitreous and do vitrectomy. But doing the capsular rexus, you can see, very difficult. We try to incorporate the capsular plaque within the capsular rexus, but this is a large capsular plaque with lots of folds present. And these folds basically make it difficult then to do a continuous rexus. This also has loose zonules as well. And here, I think the best answer is maybe femto might be helpful here, mind you. But if you don't have femto, then using an RF or a Clody device may be helpful, or using micro scissors like this to basically start the initial capsular rexus and then do as much of a tear as you can, and then use sharp instrumentation, whether they're needles or whether they're forceps or scissors, to propagate this tear. And you see there are certain areas where I can do a continuous tear. It's nice to do a continuous tear in some areas because it may allow the lens to be better positioned, even though the capsulotomy will be irregular. And so the use of micro scissors are helpful. At the end, we will use another cut here along the temporal side to allow us to make this one continuous rexus. So it's just something to consider when we manage these cases that are challenging. The pediatric cataract is also one to be mindful of. We typically have to make adjustments, including the use of a super viscous agent like Helon 5. Again, very helpful, like you see here. But also just watch as we do the capsular rexus, how the capsule wants to run out. And so we need to change our vector forces to really pull toward the center. And you can see by doing this, we're exaggerating the vector that we're pulling with, but it allows the rexus to be performed in a good, proper manner to allow us to continue and create a nice round capsular rexus. And that's something I think that is a helpful approach in these challenging cases. The other thing I think is nice to do as well in these situations here, when they're pediatric cataracts, is to be comfortable doing a posterior capsular rexus. And here you can see we're going to inject viscoelastic and then use a 25-gauge needle to break the capsule and then continue with the capsular rexus. Now, this capsular rexus is like an anterior capsular rexus. The difference is it's thinner, and we're working at a more steeper angle. And so it's helpful to use a microforceps. It's helpful with viscoelastic behind the posterior capsule to maintain Berger space and keep vitreous back, keep the anterior hallux intact. And then we basically need to re-grab. The big difference between posterior and anterior rexus is the need to re-grasp frequently because it's very thin and not as controllable. So re-grab frequently. But really, if you can do an anterior capsular rexus, I believe is something that you can reasonably do quite well, a posterior capsular rexus. And again, this may be something that is helpful in pediatric cases like here, or maybe also helpful when we have, for example, a PC rent, as you see here. The PC has been opened during phaco with a circular cut with the phaco tip. This may be stable, but really it's at risk for running out. So make a little snip and then basically convert this to a posterior rexus. And so posterior rexus is a nice way, again, to manage a tear, to create that nice continuous curvilinear tear, which will allow us to create a nice capsular bag and put the eye wall in the capsular bag. Let me just show you maybe two more cases of a zonule case here. One thing to keep in mind in these cases is the capsular rexus is not going to be the same size and the same shape as a regular capsulotomy. Make these oval eyes, in this case, follow the contour of the bag and make them smaller than you normally would. Otherwise, we run into the zonules here. Remember, the capsulotomy will stretch. Once you put a capsular tension ring in or segments in, the capsulotomy stretch. Look how round it is now after you put the CTR and CTS in. And even with the CTR and CTS in, you can see we're also doing a posterior rexus in this case. Again, start the rexus with a sharp needle, bevel down, inject viscoelastic, and then do your capsular rexus. And be sure to try to get it centered here and make it at least not more than 5 millimeters, maybe a little bit less even. So if you wanted to, you can also do a posterior optic buttonhole. And by that, I mean basically is put the lens in the eye, as you'll see, and prolapse the optic behind the capsulotomy. So those are just some tricks and pearls, Arup. I just want to, again, thank you for having me here. Lots of stuff to talk about with capsular rexus. I have more videos, of course, online, and always love to see you all on social media, which has been our only way to keep in touch, unfortunately, during the pandemic. And I look forward to seeing us all in person and whether in India or otherwise in the future. So thank you very much, Arup, for inviting me here.
Thank you so much, Ike. Wonderful series of videos. I just wanted to ask you, see, in the pediatric cataracts that you demonstrated, would it be okay to stain the anterior capsule with tripan blue dye? You know, the tearing the anterior capsule becomes that much easier if it is stained with tripan blue dye.
Yeah, I agree. I'm one who believes that with tripan blue, it does reduce the elasticity of the anterior capsule. And so these very elastic eyes, I think, can benefit from stiffening a little bit with the tripan blue. I think it's a great idea. Also, with the cases with folds in the capsule, sometimes it's subtle. They really show the folds nicely and a white lens. Where I don't use tripan blue is aniridia eyes, because these can cause a more brittle capsule, which already is brittle enough because of the aniridia syndrome. And so in those cases, I typically use a light pipe. I didn't show it, but to use side illumination to visualize the capsule if you need to.
Madhu, anything you wanted to ask?
It was a nice teaching videos, Dr. Ike. And I want to add one thing, like in intumescent cataract, instead of initiating a linear cut, you can start with curved nick so that it doesn't extend to the periphery and cause an Argentine and plaque sign. So if it extends also, it will extend in circumferential manner. So it is one tip from my side.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes you hardly have any time because as soon as you make the cut, then everything comes loose. And so sometimes it's hard to be able to even do any kind of a curve. But it's a good idea. I just go right in and I pull right back with my syringe, which is filled with some BSS with a vapor lock. And that way I get that liquefied cortex out right away before I do any other maneuver. And so it happens so quickly that I think it can help decompress in those situations.
See, what I feel is, you know, in an intumescent cataract, if your first puncture doesn't run away to the periphery and it does so later on, it's an iatrogenic one. Mm. It is the first puncture that matters. Whether you make a C or make a U, I think that perhaps is irrelevant. If the first puncture is what is important, and that is the time when you have to aspirate, you know, the liquefied cortex superficially. And so any other comments? Saurabh, any comments on the talk?
Yeah, I think Dr. Ike, amazing presentation, and we follow your channel and your videos, and amazing instrumentation. I think that's what makes, you know, huge difference for us. I would like to suggest one more instrument which I use frequently. It's a microcapsulorhexis forceps, just like an intravitreal forceps, so which can go from the side port. And for youngsters, I think, who don't have good control or to go through the main incision, I think that also is quite useful for us.
Exactly.
So, great point. Absolutely. I mean, these can fit through a sub 1 millimeter incision or tiny, right? And so you're absolutely right. They're very helpful for that. You have to be mindful, of course, to not move the eye too much, but it really keeps a nice seal. So very good point. There are some specially designed microrexus forceps, as you know, or you have to steal one from the retina surgeons if you don't have it.
So Deepak, you're ready with your presentation?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. I would like you to continue and give your expert comments. You know, we have a lot of, if possible, you know.
I will try. I have to step out. I just got a call from a patient I need to just see, perhaps. But I will try to come back for sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
difficult to tear. The
So I'll be talking about the calcified and the fibrotic capsules.
Calcified capsules, which are commonly seen.
Is the audio from the film, is it heard?
Yeah, it's audible.
In hypermature and long-standing cataracts pose quite a few challenges for the cataract surgeon. The problem is, of course, during the creation of the erexus. The calcified capsule is difficult to tear, difficult to control, and vulnerable for peripheral extension, and also exerts significant amount of zonular stress during its creation. So where does the problem lie really?
To understand this, we need to first realize that all calcified capsules are not the same. I'd like to broadly classify them into two distinct variants, the one with an underlying calcified plaque and the other being the fibrotic variant. And both require different techniques to conquer them. In the first variant, that is the one with the plaque.
The problem lies in the calcified plaque, which is actually below the anticapsule, but strongly adherent to the overlying anticapsule.
And these plaques
make the capsular tear behave in an unpredictable manner. So what's the solution? Well, the answer is quite simple. Get rid of the plaque. And let us see how we can do this in the next few cases. So this is one such calcified capsule in an hypermature cataract in an elderly patient. The arrow marks show the extent of the subcapsular plaque.
My plan is to use this three-step strategy. First, to perform a small primary erexus, remove the underlying plaque, and then make the erexus bigger.
I begin by making a small puncture in the anticapsule, and we can see that it's so difficult to tear. And we can see the enormous amount of stress which is being imparted on the zonules. A small central capsular erexus could be managed. Now is the time to deal with the underlying plaque. I am creating a cleavage plane between the anticapsule and the plaque using a combination of blunt and visco dissection. Then using a forceps, part of the calcified plaque is gently separated from the anticapsule and peeled off. As we can see, a ring of calcified plaque still continues to remain. Again, using a forceps, the subcapsular plaque is gently being freed from the overlying anticapsule. Again, a combination of mechanical and visco dissection helps in separating the last few attachments. And finally, the entire plaque is gently pulled out. And in the absence of the pathological plaque, the anticapsule behaves just fine. The erexus is enlarged, and this is how it looks after the completion of the erexus. The nucleus is emulsified easily. Well, the case essentially becomes a routine one once the calcified plaque is taken out. Now moving on to the next case, again a calcified capsule in a hypermature cataract in an elderly patient. Again, the area of the calcified plaque is being highlighted. The plan is to do a small erexus, then dissect out and remove subcapsular plaque, and then enlarge the erexus. After the initial puncture, a small erexus could be created. Again, I'm using a combination of visco and mechanical dissection to separate the plaque from the overlying anticapsule. In this case, I'm using a flat iris spatula to break the adhesions of the calcified plaque with the overlying anticapsule. With a little bit of patience and perseverance, separation of the plaque from the overlying capsule could be achieved. Part of the erexus is being enlarged. And now I'm attempting to remove the plaque. A part of the plaque has extended to the periphery, making the situation slightly tricky. Pulling it is going to induce stress on the zonules. So I'm using a second instrument to provide countertraction. This will help me out to pull the plaque without inducing much damage or stress to the zonules. Once the plaque is out, the capsule behaves in a routine fashion, as if nothing was wrong with it in the first place. So these two cases teach us the fact that if you can manage the underlying subcapsular calcified plaque, RECCS could be performed and managed pretty well in these hypermature cataracts with calcified capsules. There is another subgroup of difficult capsules comprising predominantly of the fibrotic variant. In these capsules, we don't have the underlying subcapsular calcified plaque. These fibrotic capsules are again difficult to manage because we can't cut them nor we can tear them. Well, there is a way to deal with this. Such capsules are best dealt with the vitreous cutter. Let us see this technique in a couple of cases. This is a long-standing traumatic cataract in a young man. He's a 28-year-old man with a long-standing traumatic cataract. Once we stain, we can clearly see many hyperstained areas representing the fibrotic zones. And these are the danger zones which have a great tendency to extend radially. While making the initial cut, I notice great tonacity of the capsule and the lentile lens is moving. The key here is to create some cleavage plane after which the vitrector is introduced under the anterior capsule. The capsulectomy is started by nibbling at the fibrotic capsule and meanwhile the liquid cortex gets simultaneously aspirated. It's important to avoid undue stretching of the capsule at the wrinkled and the hyperstained areas because these areas is vulnerable for radial extension of the tear. The capsulectomy with the cutter is continued until a circular opening of the desired size is created. The tiny nucleus is then aspirated and after removing the cortex, a multi-piece foldable lens is implanted into the bag. Point to note here is the ability of the capsulotomy margin to withstand the stretch during the maneuvering of the lens into the bag. We could achieve a perfectly circular, well-centered, adequately sized capsulotomy in this complex case. Another young patient with a long-standing traumatic cataract which is membranous and has a fibrotic capsule. It's extremely difficult to puncture the capsule and initiate RECCS in this case. After the puncture, a cleavage is created and then a 23G cutter is used to perform the capsulotomy using high cut rates. The technique is very simple. I'm just holding the vitreous cutter under the capsule to perform the capsulotomy while my left hand is holding the irrigation handpiece. With very little effort and stress on the zonules, we can achieve a decent sized capsulotomy in this complex case of fibrotic capsule. Vitreous cutter works very well in such fibrotic capsules. The high-speed vitrector cuts the capsule without putting any stress on the zonules. In such fibrotic capsules, vitrector is a great tool which can be used to perform adequate sized capsulotomies with reasonably strong margins which can withstand usual surgical maneuvers during cataract surgery. To summarize, calcified and fibrotic capsules are challenging for the cataract surgeon. But by using the right technique and the tool, we can successfully deal with these complex cases.
That's it. Thank you for your attention.
Deepak, it was really mesmerizing quality of videos and wonderful surgical skills. Any questions? Madhu, I think you wanted to have a few questions for Deepak.
Yes, very nice video in fibrotic and calcified capsule. One question that what is your setting for that vitrectomy cutter for this for cutting capsule?
Preferably you need to use a fresh new cutter so that is very sharp and the cut rate is set at the maximum what we can have. Usually I set it around 2500 and flow rate is very less. We use a peristaltic machine here, so the flow rate has to be around 10 to 14 and vacuum would be around 300 millimeters of mercury. The important one to have a very fresh cutter so that it can puncture this.
And most of this type of cases will have weak zonules. So whether it can support capsule hooks and CTR?
The fibrotic edges, which are cut by this margin, we have a C shape, the concavity towards the inside. So they have very little tendency to run away. Unlike the can opener ones we have, the can opener, if you see the edges, they are pointing towards the periphery. Unlike this, when we cut with the vitreous cutter, they have a C, which is concavity towards the center. And I have used iris hooks and capsule hooks in few cases
reasonably stable. They can withstand your regular maneuvers, like, you know, dialing the lens in, putting a CTR inside. They all can withstand.
You use a larger probe in these cases, Dr. Deepak? Or do you use 23 gauge? Or
no, I've used only 23 gauge.
23 gauge.
Yeah. But if the capsule is very, very fibrotic, very thick, then probably we may have to slow down the cut rate. Instead of using 2,500, I use 1,000 there, because you get a larger biting efficiency. It holds on to it for, so you just use, cut down the cutting rate. But the trick is always to use a sharp one.
So I agree. I think those are great pearls. I think I was going to say that the cut rate should be lowered, in my opinion. I think that if you really have a very high cut rate, then you will find it doesn't really have enough aspiration of the material. So I think it's a great idea. As you said, Deepak, to turn the cut rate down. But I mean, great pearls on managing those tough cases with plaques. I agree, the plaques you can often strip out. I'm not always successful, mind you, in my experience, to always remove them, but it's a good way to start it and try it. And then using the retractor is, I think, another great idea to help
The point was, all these capsules look the same from the outside, but once you stain and try to search for them, there are two distinct varieties. If you can identify the plaque, then always spend a little bit more time to dissect the plaque out. If you can identify and dissect out the plaque, well, then it's fine. Then not, then you are dealing with another variant, that's a fibrotic variant, then you have to resort to your cutter.
Yeah, so if you have OCT ahead of time, sometimes this can help to identify this. If you do preoperative antiseptic OCT, I think, or UBM.
Yes, that's a good point. Excellent
point as well.
So what about, the application of Femto or Zepto in these kind of situations? Those who have access to Zepto and Femto, Ike or Tom or Haripriya.
The problem with Zepto, that the depth of the cut is not enough. It's I don't remember what exactly it is. I think it's like 25 or 30 microns. It's not deep enough. So I have found it leaves a bit of an imprint, but doesn't necessarily do that. But Femto laser, sure. Femto, I turn the energy up and you can set your gates up wider. It can actually do a reasonable job. Again, if there's a plaque, it's a little bit more difficult, but just with the folds, yes, I think it's a good approach if you have access to that.
Shelly wanted to say something.
Yeah, I think some of these extreme fibrotic cases, like Dr. Ike correctly mentioned, if there's a plaque, usually the femto doesn't cut through. So even it may cut through the intact capsule, which is not having the plaque, but the plaque, you would generally have to cut it with the scissors, even with the femto rex in such situations.
If I may add a little bit, I don't have access to femto, but if I had femto, I would like to get the small first rexes, the initial small mini rexes. That could be done with the femto. Then through that, we have access to dissect out and remove the flap. So that would be worthwhile. We can't cut the flap. It can't cut the plaque.
Okay, thank you.
We have tried in a fibrotic capsule, sir. We have tried in few fibrotic capsule, but it doesn't cut with femto.
Okay, thank you, Deepak. It was a wonderful display of your surgical skills and complex cases and good discussion. So now I request Tom, with your presentation, video-based presentation.
Well, that was a great presentation. I really appreciate that, Dr. Deepak. I hate to follow it because it was so good. I want to talk about weak zonules. And what I want to do is give some tips that might be useful to people of various levels. One of the great things about the courses in general that Arup puts on is he tends to give courses that have tips for people of all levels. And that's one of the things I really respect about his amazing career of education. And so that's what I want to try to do. I've just got some five tips I want to focus on. So the first one I think is really important and it's kind of subtle. And that's the idea of using a sideways Arshinoff shell. So the idea here is we're going to place dispersive viscoelastic in the area of the weakened zonules, as you can see here in this video. And now across from that, we're going to place cohesive viscoelastic, and we're going to use that dispersive the cohesive viscoelastic to jam the dispersive in place. And so now we have a nice protective coating of dispersive viscoelastic, which is wedged in the area of zonular weakness. So this is sort of sideways because the usual Arshinoff shell has the dispersive up against the cornea, But now we want the dispersive viscoelastic into the area of weakened zonules using the sideways technique. And I'll show you a couple examples where we use that some more. So the second tip I want to emphasize is that when you're doing visco dissection for an early capsular tension ring, in other words, a capsular tension ring that you're placing when you still have lens material in place, you want to make sure that you don't trap cortical material with the capsular tension ring. And this can be a tricky problem, particularly if you use a standard capsular tension ring as opposed to one like the Henderson ring, which has little wavelets in it. So a standard capsular tension ring can trap cortical material. So the key here is to use cohesive viscoelastic to make a dissection between the residual lens material and the capsule. So the big difference is to use cohesive viscoelastic in this case to get just under the anterior capsule, place the cohesive viscoelastic before you place the early capsular tension ring. And I'll show you some examples of that in just a second. So that's the second tip. The third tip is, and maybe this is obvious to you, maybe it's not. It seems to be a source of confusion, I think, as people are learning. And that is that the capsular tension ring has two ways it can come out. And so it can either come out to the right or it can come out to the left. And so when you ask for a preloaded capsular tension ring, you have to pay attention to this. And so you can see in this box on the right, this is a preloaded Mortra capsular tension ring. You can see it says right on it. And the right refers to which way the capsular tension ring is going to come out of the cartridge. And it's not about the right eye. It's not anything funny like that. It's the way it comes out of the cartridge. And you want to think about this in situations where you know where the zonules are weak. So if you know the zonules are weak on the right relative to your incision, then you want to get a capsular tension ring that comes out towards the weak zonules or comes out towards the right. Now, sometimes you load it yourself. And if you load it yourself, you want to load it in a way so that it comes out in a way that is a best value to your surgery. So keep that in mind, that there's two directions and that you're in charge of how that works. The fourth tip, and this is really important, and then I just want to emphasize how powerful optic capture can be. We talked about reverse optic capture earlier, which I think is really useful, but I'm talking about traditional optic capture where the haptics are in the sulcus and the optic is in the bag. This is a very powerful way to secure a lens when you have weakened zonules, particularly if you supplement that with a capsular tension ring in the bag. So the combination of optic capture with a capsular tension ring in the bag is really a powerful way to secure a lens with weak zonules. And I've been shocked over the years at how useful this can be and about how much zonular weakness you can still have with this technique holding the lens secure. So the idea, of course, is you're gonna put the haptics in the sulcus, you're gonna prolapse the optic posteriorly into the bag and secure the lens. And I'm gonna show you some examples of that in just a second. There's no adjustment needed for the IOL power. The optic is very close to the effective lens position of being planned for the bag. And so there's no reason to worry much about the optic, the power of the optic. So here's an example that shows a couple of those tips. So you can see there's an area of weakened zonules on the left there. We're gonna do the sideways Arshinoff shell where we place the dispersive viscoelastic first. Now we're placing cohesive viscoelastic and we're gonna jam that dispersive viscoelastic into the area of the weakened zonules. Now we're gonna make our rexus and we're gonna center the rexus on the lens, not on the pupil. And now we're using cohesive visco dissection for the planned early placement of a capsular tension ring. We're getting just under the anterior capsule with a cohesive viscoelastic. And now we're gonna go in with a left aimed capsular tension ring because the weak zonules are on the left side. We're getting just under the anterior capsule. Oh, not quite there. Make sure you're just under the anterior capsule. Lift up, use that dissected space and place that capsular tension ring so that it doesn't trap any cortical material. And look how nicely it centers the lens. And really the rest of the case was relatively routine after early placement. You can see we put the haptics in the sulcus and the optic in the bag, and I'll talk about that in just a few more minutes. So that's the basic tips I wanted to show you for that. So here's the fifth and final tip, and I'm gonna show you a couple other examples. The use of a Sinsky hook when placing the capsular tension ring can be really, really useful. You can see how this kid got trapped here in this playground equipment. It's kind of silly. All of his buddies are trying to get his head out from this silly place that he stuck his head. And sometimes a capsular tension ring can get into trouble with But I mainly want to emphasize the power of a Sinsky-guided capsular tension ring for your surgery. So here's the example I was just talking about, which is analogous to that kid getting his head caught. And I want to go through the use of MST capsule retractors, which I really love. These are capsule retractors which are useful for loose zonules. Here you can see the Rexus is perfect. This is one of our residents did this surgery. It's a beautiful job. We're placing these MST retractors. You make the paracentesis more like a 60-degree incision, so it's not as flat as the incision that you make for an iris hook. And we're going to place these and sort of get them loosely in place first. We've done some cohesive viscodissection so that the space between the capsule and the lens is freed up. We're just going to loosely place these first, not putting any stress on the zonules. Just get them in place. And once we have all four in place, then we'll tighten them up a little bit right across from each other to secure the lens. And once you have these four retractors in place, the nuclear fractus is relatively trivial. They have tremendous power. Now we're placing the capsular tension ring in, and you won't really notice at first, but there's a problem that occurs here. The capsular tension ring is going pretty well. There's really not much worry. We don't really have any concerns. We're really excited until we notice this right here. So in an odd turn of events, the capsular tension ring went right through the gap in the capsule retractor. So let's take out the other ones first. Maybe the problem will go away. We'll take out these other MST retractors, just hoping that the problem goes away, but of course it doesn't go away. What we end up having to do is cut the MST retractor to get it out of there. And it's very sharp edges here, so we're being very careful. We got that little tidbit there left. We weren't sure whether to remove it or not, but we ended up deciding to remove the little tidbit. And this is our chief resident, Luke Lindsay, doing this removal. I thought it was a beautiful job of using the two hands together. And so anyway, I want to show you a technique that eliminates this risk of sort of running these through the MST retractor. So if you use this Sinsky hook to guide that leading eyelet, around. And so you can very gently place the capsular tension ring in with very little force on the bag, and you can avoid the MST retractors as shown here. So now I just wanted to prove to you that we really did avoid it. So using that technique, I've never caught an MST retractor. Now these MST retractors come in two styles. One is revised by Dr. David Chang, who's I know a mentor to many of us here. And basically what he did was he squeezed it together so there's no way a capsular tension ring can go through the opening. The disadvantage of the Chang technique is it doesn't have as broad a coverage of the equator of the capsular bag. So I still honestly like the standard one a little bit better, but the Chang one eliminates that problem. The Sinsky placement of the capsular tension ring is also useful in cases like this. You can see there's really loose zonules here. We were able to wrestle the lens out of here, but we've got very loose zonules. So we're placing viscoelastic, and now we're going to place the capsular tension ring. And look what happens. It catches in a fold. The bag is so loose that the capsular tension ring catches in a fold and really begins to cause more harm than good here. And so we really are getting a lot of force on the capsular tension ring here as it tries to go in this very loose bag. Look at how the zonules are actually weaker right across from the incision. So now we're going to just do the exact same thing, but we're going to use this Sinsky guided technique. And you can see how just by guiding the capsular tension ring with a Sinsky hook, how much more gentle the insertion is in this exact same case. And now we're able to place a lens in the sulcus. And I just want to show you this lens here going into the sulcus. And we're going to do this traditional optic capture where both of the haptics are in the sulcus. But we're going to place this optic into the bag. So you usually tuck half of it in, remove viscoelastic from below. And sometimes, though, I'm just going to show you, sometimes it actually takes two instruments, two hands to get that in the proper position. You can see I'm using two instruments here now, one to push down a little bit and the other, the Kugelin, to lift the capsule up over the optic to get it into final position. And this lens was remarkably stable, given how loose that bag was just a few minutes ago. So this particular position with the haptics in the bag and a capsule tension ring in is very, very powerful and stable. And I'm gonna show just one more case. This is a placement of an early capsular tension ring. And I just want to emphasize in these cases how useful it can be to have to use soft prolapse. There's a gap right here. You can see there's a gap right here. The zonules are really weak. Now, we've already stained, but before we stained, we didn't protect that area with viscoelastic. And so one of the things you're going to notice is Tri-Pen Blue snuck around there and ended up sort of ruining our red reflex, because Tri-Pen Blue got through that stain because we didn't use that initial viscoelastic for protection. So you can see we have a very poor red reflex here because we've had Tri-Pen Blue, which has gone around. But here we're placing an earlier capsular tension ring. We're using that Sinsky technique. And you'll see that the lens is actually reformed a bit. The capsular tension ring is all the way out to the equator of the lens. But it's a long-standing defect there, and so the lens has a little dent in it, a little bite out of it. Oftentimes, these traumatic cases like this are very soft lenses, and one of the techniques that I like to use is just to prolapse the whole lens up with a bunch of hydrodissection and hydrodelineation, and then you can go in often with your IA unit underneath the soft lens and remove it. So these soft lenses often are associated with, these zonular problems are often associated with soft lenses. In this case, we're just placing single piece of acrylic in the bag. And there's nothing too exciting about that. The point on this, you can still see the Tri-Pen there in the red reflex. And that's because we didn't seal it off before we started the case. And so the Tri-Pen Blue is still a little bit evident there. There really wasn't a lot of Tri-Pen Blue when we saw the patient post-operative later that day. But it made the case a little bit more tricky. So in summary, I think the sideways Aschenoff shell is a very useful technique. So the idea with the sideways Aschenoff shell is you put the viscote in the area of the weak zonules, and then you put cohesive viscoelastic on the other side, and you sort of wedge that dispersive viscoelastic into the area of weak zonules. It can make the rest of the case a lot easier. More and more, I've found going myself to an earlier placement of a capsular tension ring. And in order to do that safely, you want to make sure that you don't trap cortical material when you place the capsular tension ring. And so I like to use cohesive viscodissection, place cohesive viscoelastic just under the anterior capsule, place the cohesive viscoelastic before you place the capsular tension ring, which goes just under the capsule, of course. The traditional optic capture is really powerful. So have that in your bag of tricks, especially traditional optic capture with the capsular tension ring in the bag. So you have the capsular tension ring you place in the bag, then you place both haptics in the sulcus, and then you prolapse the optic back. No need to adjust the power. And finally, I think you need to have a way to guide the capsular tension ring that doesn't cause iatrogenic trauma to the zonules. And I really like this technique of a Sinsky hook or a small hook to guide the leading eyelid of the capsular tension ring into the bag. It's a useful technique. The way I would suggest you learn that is to first practice on cases where you don't need it. In other words, to use this technique when the zonules are pretty good, but you just need a little bit of a capsular tension ring, and so you're not as dependent on it, because at first it's a little bit tricky to get the two hands together. On the right here, I'm just showing a video in this cataract surgery website that we have. I just wanted to emphasize how useful simulated eyes can be for practicing things like this. And for those of you that are learning, or those of you that have downtime from this horrible virus, you may find that you've got some downtime to work in your own operating room. The great thing about these simulated eyes is you can take these simulated eyes, like there's several companies that have them. The one I'm showing here is from Craig Phillips. And you can take them into your operating room and you can practice. And so you can practice MST retractors or practice a capsular tension ring or practice one of Dr. Ahmed's capsular tension segments. You can practice the small instruments that we've been talking about all morning in these simulated eyes in your operating room. It's a very powerful way to practice and get good before you take these patients to your operating room. So thank you. Thank you, Arup, for inviting me. It's such a pleasure to be in this group. And I also just want to thank Arup for all of your wonderful training over the years to me and all the many residents here in the United States. We certainly appreciate your great educational efforts. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Tom, for the kind comments and the wonderful videos. The tips that you have conveyed through your videos are really great. There are a few questions I just wanted to ask you. Number one is, why do you have a cohesive visco dissection? Why don't you use a dispersive visco dissection? Any particular reason?
Well, I think that's a good question. I used to always use dispersive viscoelastic when I was trying to make the dissection between the capsule and the rest of the lens. And I think the cohesive works better because it doesn't really get wedged up and stick to the cortical and epinuclear lens material. And it just gives you a much cleaner dissection between the anterior capsule and the rest of the lens. And so I've tried both. And I think actually I learned this from Ike Ahmed in his curbside book, where he talked about using cohesive visco dissection in this setting. And it just works, in my opinion, it works better. So try both, see what you think. But I think the cohesive gives you a cleaner dissection and you're less likely to trap residual cortical material.
There's several companies that have them. The one I'm
sure. I agree, Tom. I think that the cohesives are certainly better at creating space. So we're trying to create space. We're not looking so much for retention here. We're looking for creating space. And I think it does that well. And I think there's less transgression into the cortex, and I think it cleaves it
in, and then place a lens in the bag so that later I could suture the lens more easily using the capsular tension ring. The reason I mentioned Dr. Harapriya is my understanding is I know for sure they've done this wonderful study at Aravind, and they found, my understanding is there's no difference between placing a three-piece or placing a single piece with a ring in those situations. So I don't know for sure if there's an advantage if the pseudo exfoliation patient has what appears to be normal zonules. I don't know if Harapriya, is she still on? Maybe she could come.
Yeah, that's her.
So that study, we are right now in the 8-year follow-up. It was a prospective trial with 1,000 patients and 500 controls. At this point, up to the 7th year, we found that we only had patients who had no pre-op or surgical zonular weakness noted. So all of them had intact zonules with pseudo exfoliation, and they didn't have small pupils as well. And up to 7 years, we did not find a difference between the eyes where we had a CTR and the eyes where we did not place a CTR. And also there was no difference based on the IOL design, a single piece or a three-piece design. Again, I think Brad Shingleton's paper showed more of decentration and dislocation at the 8-year follow-up. So we don't know yet, but as of now, there is absolutely no difference, and the rate of decentration is extremely low in these eyes.
Thank you so much, Ike. Anything? One last comment from you before we move on to the next talk.
Yeah, I think the pseudo-exfoliation one is fascinating. I think there's really little evidence that the zonules are completely intact and normal during the case. If they're not normal, then I think I like the idea. Honestly, I do the same thing, Tom. I mean, put a CTR in the bag. I do capsule polishing, and I then put an optic capture position with the sulcus haptics, and hope that that may help support the the haptics in there. Of course, if there's overt, if there's a lot of phacodenesis, then I really put a capsular tension segment in. Or two and suture it, or a steel earring could be used, and I suture it to use the bag. So I think those are my levels. If there's overt posterior tilt and overt, subluxation of the lens in pseudo-exfoliation, I'll put a CTS, CTR in the bag, suture it. If it's, very subtle and the bag is a little bit, this phacodenesis a little bit, but there's no overt tilting of the lens and there's no overt, transverse movement, then I'll put a CTR in the bag and three-piece lens in the optic capture sulcus position. And if everything looks completely great, no problem, it's a routine case, then I think there's, and I will still capsule polish though. I do that for exfoliation. I will basically do what I normally do, which is a one piece lens in the bag right now. That's typically my routine.
Thanks a lot, Ike. And then we move on to the second last talk, Sayan. Your toric I will. Sayan Das.
Yeah, yes, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I wish to thank Dr. Arup, sir, for giving me an opportunity to be in this all-star lineup. So I'll be speaking on reducing parallax error with manual markers, specifically the Mendez ring and the corneal meridian marker for toric IOL alignment. So diagrammatically speaking, considering the eye in the anatomical position, usually we mark the 6 o'clock position around the limbus with the patient sitting head erect and looking straight ahead. And considering that the proposed IOL placement meridian is 0 to 180 degree, this holds true for any meridian. The IOL orientation marks are imprinted on the limbus. They should be such that they are diagonally opposite and the line joining them should pass through the visual axis. This is the most important point. So if the Mendez ring is not placed circumferentially parallel to the limbus, the IOL orientation marks will not be placed diagonally as shown by the red marks here. And the IOL orientation marks will actually not be on any meridian passing through the visual axis. And the IOL axis marking dots will not conform to both the limbal alignment marks diagonally opposite, and the IOL will be oriented in a wrong meridian. And the same thing happens in whichever direction the Mendez ring is decentered. So for proper alignment and to reduce parallax error, the 6 o'clock position of the limbus is first marked with the patient sitting upright. The Mendez ring is placed circumferentially parallel to the limbus. The corneal meridian marker is oriented along the proposed IOL alignment meridian as marked by the Mendez ring. And what is most important, the take-home message is that the central aperture of the corneal meridian marker should be positioned in such a way that we get the first Purkinje image centered within the aperture. And this ensures us that we are passing right through the center along the meridian. Then the error in placing the IOL alignment marks along the meridian will be minimized. And after implantation, the axis marking dots on the IOL will superimpose with both the limbal IOL alignment marks. So I have a very short video. So this is the Mendez ring, and here we have the right eye, the surgeon sitting with the in the superior position, and the planned incision location and the IOL orientation is at 105. And what we have to notice here that the first Purkinje image is centered within this central aperture of the corneal meridian marker, and that will help us in reducing the parallax error. And then when we implant the IOL here under a hydro implantation, since the diagonally positioned IOL alignment marks are really diagonal, the IOL marking dots on the IOL superimpose on both the limbal alignment marks on both the sides, and we can reduce parallax error in such a way. Thank you so much,
sir. A very useful presentation, Sayan. And before we move on to Saurav's presentation, anybody would like to comment on this technique? Ike, don't you think it is a very cute technique?
Yeah, it's very great principles, and it is a cute technique, as you said. I think there are many ways to do this, and I think those principles are important. I typically just use a one step at the slit lamp and or at the bedside, and just use a rotatable dial and essentially mark the steep axis or the intended axis in one step. But I think either way, the principles you've described very nicely here.
Any comments, Shail?
No, sir, I think the presentation was excellent. The only thing that we do differently now is that whenever we do manual marking, we have stopped marking on both sides. Because in spite of all the principles being followed, it's almost impossible that you can align both the dots on both the sides together because of all the parallax and centration and things. So generally, we when we mark for the IOL placement, we just mark one side towards the line of the surgeon, which is closer to the surgeon.
Which side do you mark?
So if it is, say, the one which is closer to the surgeon, to the surgical incision side.
Tom, anything else you would like to contribute to this presentation?
No, it was a great presentation. It's such a tricky situation to get it just right, and I think it's a great technique.
Okay, we move on to the last presentation. Saurav, Sayan, you have to stop the share screen feature so that Saurav can get in. Yeah.
Yeah, and I would like to thank Dr. Aru for inviting me for such an excellent session, and I learned a lot during this session. So I will be showing a video how to tackle the post-toric surprises, because many times we start off with the toric practice and we get across these surprises, and then how to tackle this. So this is a short presentation. Here we go.
Nandadeep Eye Hospital, Sangli, India. And in this video, I'll be discussing about the toric troubleshooting. What can be done after we have a refractive surprise after toric IOL? So when we get a patient with a kind of keratometry like this, where there is cylinder of four diopters, obviously any ophthalmologist is geared up to do a nice toric IOL so as to give perfect vision to the patient. So you start reassuring the patient about the great vision in the post-operative period, and you go ahead with the toric IOL surgery. You have done a perfect surgery on table. You are already dreaming that the patient is going to get the perfect outcome and going to be happy. But sometimes this happens. What we intended and what happened. So there is a murder of our respect and confidence in front of our patient. When there is a homicide, we have to call the best detective in the world. So when we start assuming something, that's the starting of failure. So let's start from the beginning. So let's reconfirm whether whatever we have done preoperatively was correct or not. Sometimes we get wrong keratometry because of warp cornea, like contact lens use, or there may be corneal haze, use of some paraquin like drops or dry eye or contact procedure done before the keratometry preoperatively. And topography was either not done or not done properly, like if there is a wrong head posture while doing topography, or if it is an irregular cornea, it itself may give rise to erroneous readings, and if you have missed that, you may land up with surprise. Also, reconfirm the calculation. Check whether you have entered the data correctly, you have got the right printout for the right patient, and whether you have used the right formula. And believe me, this can go wrong sometimes, where instead of 0 degree, you enter 90 degree as flat axis, and you get IOL placed 90 degree apart. Also, have a look at surgically induced astigmatism. If you haven't calculated it, use this website to calculate your SIA. But remember, SIA is just a mean of different values, and there will be outliers. Particularly in cases where you have taken incision right through a scar, or you are operating on a thinner cornea and you have made an incision which is too central, you may have erroneously high SIA. So in the post-operative period, you have to check that whether that was one of the causes for the surprise. Now, by this time, our optom is quite, angry with us, because there was no mistake from his side in this case. Everything was perfect. So what was the problem? So we have to check the IOL position where we did something wrong in that. So to check that on slit lamp, you just have to use a thin slit beam, and then you can rotate this beam and align it in case with dilated pupil along the toricoil marks and check the actual position of the IOL in degrees. And there is a better way to do it using the iToric Android app. You just take a good retro image on autorefractometer using infrared, and then you can check the exact position of the IOL. You can do the same thing with a costlier machine like iTrace. Of course, the iToric is free of charge. Another important thing is to do good post-operative refraction, not just subjective one, but also objective one. Do good retinoscopy and autorefractometry, because this is going to decide whether I need to exchange the IOL or I can just rotate the IOL and do good. So if you have very high spherical equivalent in the post-operative period, exchange might be needed, because just rotating the IOL may not be sufficient. Now, when you have this kind of surprise, you think, am I the only guilty one to have such kind of refractive errors? Just to remind you that all over the world, the data suggests that only 70% patients achieve more than 20 by 25 vision. So there will be some residual error left in 30% patients. Of course, you need to realign the IOL only if it goes beyond 10 degree. And on an average, if you see, 1 out of 100 toric IOL needs readjustment. Another important study, which is important for our case, is that repositioning should be performed after 1 week. If you do it very early, there is a chance that it may re-rotate. So when should it be rotated? Less than 8 weeks post-operatively is easier to correct. Of course, in individual case, you can do it later also. And always better to wait for 3 weeks for the capsule to become little more sticky and then rotate the IOL. Now, how much to rotate? It's a difficult question unless you are a champion mathematician. But we have these websites by Dr. Alpins, www.assort.com. Or there is another website, astigmatismfix.com. There is a analyzer by Dr. Barrett on ACRS website to check the toric results. So you can use either of these. You have to enter the correct data and you can get the advice from this website. So let's look at this patient which I was mentioning about. So a perfect patient for toric IOL. I selected the lens properly using the online calculator. Surgery was uneventful, that's what I thought. And the post-operative refraction, see the amount of cylinder which was left, minus 9 diopter. So I used this website, assort.com. I entered all the post-operative data. We have to enter the post-operative keratometry. We have to enter which IOL was placed, which model, and which cylinder power was placed inside the eye. And then we have to enter exactly what is the axis at which the IOL is lying here. So here the IOL was at 160 degree. And then I entered the objective refractive error in the post-operative period. And what this site is telling me is that I have to rotate this IOL 85 degrees counterclockwise. Wow, that's a huge rotation that I have to do. So what did I miss this? This website will also tell us when you start rotating this IOL, how the astigmatism is going to decrease. So if you see the present position of the IOL, you will find that there is 9 diopter of astigmatism, and as you rotate it 85 degrees, you will have closer to 0.5 to 1 diopter astigmatism. So that's great. So where did I go wrong here? So in the preoperative sheet which was given to me, the IOL was supposed to be placed at 63 degree, and I just placed it at 163 degree. Because why? Because my fellow said something and I heard 163. So I placed it at 163. So believe me, we can go wrong in such a manner also. Nonetheless, lessons learned. So I decided to take up this patient 3 weeks post-operatively. This is a hydrophilic plate haptic design. So you can mark the new axis, which is 65 degree here, by marking the 0, 180 degree using the iToric marker, or simply you can measure 85 degrees counterclockwise from the position of the IOL, which doesn't require any reference marking. Then we have to separate the anterior and posterior capsule. You can use the iris spatula. You can also use the cohesive viscoelastic agent to split or cleave the anterior and posterior capsule. And if you are doing it within 2 months, I think it is quite easy to do it. Later, there might be some fibrosis and you have to be careful. So once that is done, I'm rotating the IOL slowly to its desired position. Once again, confirming I don't want another procedure in this eye, and yeah, this is what I got. Very little refractive error and 6x6. The patient is very happy. So I think even if you get the worst kind of refractive surprises, you can tackle it very well. To complete the list, there are other methods to deal with the compound astigmatic error or spherical surprises post-toric IOLs. We can simply do corneal refractive procedure like surface ablation, femtoelastic or SMILE. We can also do a piggyback IOL like Celcoflex to take care of the residual refractive error. So if the error cannot be corrected by rotation of the IOL, I think we can do this. We can also exchange the old IOL and implant the properly calculated IOL to take care of the refractive error, and there are many other ways to do that. So thank you very much for your kind listening.
Thank you, Saurabh, for a very well managed complication. And I think, you know, this is sort of a Pandora's box. There are a lot of questions that spring up to your mind, and you know, how to avoid this complication and what are the various options, how to go about dealing with it. I would like to have comments from everybody here, and Haripriya, let's say Madhu. So how do you manage, how to avoid such kind of complication in your toric practice? Obviously, there's a communication gap. So something needs to be tightened up. So what do you do at Aravind for that? Madhu?
Yes, sir. Actually, this type of transcription error, or sometimes we have seen that a few cases of transcription error also, like one of the cases, we saw that instead of putting at 90 degree forward, we put it on 180 degree, and it went almost in opposite direction. So that type of transcription error, we have to make checklist at several points. So before implanting IOL, we have to check whether it is with the rule or against the rule. That is the most important part. So this toric seat and a scan seat, we have to cross check whether it is similar to that or not, whether it is showing with the rule and something is wrong on that toric seat. So that part we have to avoid. And sometimes on Varian also, we have found that instead of switching from incision axis to IOL placement axis, if we have not changed that switch over from incision axis to axis placement, then we have also seen that there is some gross error in that condition.
Yeah, I think so, it's a good point. Yeah, Deepak, anything you wanted to say? Deepak, you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, I think, Saurav, that was a very great presentation. I think we all have experienced the same situation I had encountered just about 6 months back. 80 degree was one thing, and I implanted 180 degrees. I think the message here is never take anything for granted. Like, you know, you can't rely on somebody telling you the access. I think the surgeon has to see it himself 2-3 times before he gets into the OT. It happens because we all take it for granted. It was intended access was 80, and I heard it as 180, and it was placed at 180. So these are all errors which I think we get. There is no end how we can do the checklist, and that is the way to go. Thank you, sir.
I think just one point for everyone to easily, you know, memorize is that the steep keratometry axis and the plus cylinder axis matches the toric. Generally, it's closer to the toricale placement. So just if you remember this, I think most of these kind of huge errors can be eliminated.
You know, what I do in my setup, because I mark myself on the slit lamp. So I have the patient's data in my smartphone. So I verify at that same moment when I'm going to do the marking. So this thing cannot happen. But in a large volume setup where we have a series of cases coming up, I think something like that can happen. Next question would be, Tom, how do you take your incisions? Always on the steep axis, or do you go for, you know, temporal 180 degrees or 0 degrees incision for all your toricaevals? Or do you make your incisions on axis?
We usually just make them where it's convenient for the surgeon, which is usually temporal, and then modify. Although I can understand the argument for making them on incision. It just makes some sense. The only comment I wanted to make was one of the things that we've done to try to get rid of the off by 90 errors, which I think is the number one error that comes from torics, is we always hang the topography right next to the IOL measure, the IOL output. And we have a couple times caught an off by 90 error. You know, one time there was a transcription error. Another time there was the wrong wrong data was entered for a patient. And that's been a nice little final check, especially in the setting at our VA hospital where I just come over there right before the surgery, and it puts me at a sort of a disadvantage not knowing the patient very well. So that's another thing you can consider. Just gives you one more little check during your time out.
What are the intraoperative? Yeah, Shail, you wanted to contribute something?
No, sir. That's the thing that we've had only two such cases where we had the steep axis fed as the flat and the flat as the steep. So the one thing that we found useful is to not do manual entry. So buy the toric suit in most of the optical biometers. So at least that data entry part can be taken care of. That cannot go wrong.
So another thing that I would like to ask you is, you know, what are the intraoperative precautions you take to make sure that the lens doesn't rotate? You can't really make sure, you know, but reduce the incidence of IOL rotation in the postoperative period. What are the things that we can do during the surgery, intraoperative period? Tom, what would you do?
Most important step for that would be,
go ahead.
Most important step would be, one is to make sure that the viscoelastic, and the second probable thing would be to make sure that the chamber doesn't flatten or shallows when you withdraw your irrigation. So always hydrate all the wounds before you actually remove your irrigation, so that the anterior posterior flattening of the chamber and rotation of the toric IOL doesn't occur. So these are two things.
Anything in addition to this?
Yeah, I also like to not overfill the chamber. So just to keep it just filled, because again, that also kind of opens up the bag and the lens can also move a little more. So I'd like to ensure it's the wound is tight, it's formed, but not overfilled as well.
Sayan? Unmute yourself.
I tap the IOL posteriorly along the posterior capsule along the rexis margin, so that it goes as far posterior as possible. And I check the IOL orientation also after removing the speculum.
Exactly. And would you ask your patient to take some rest for about a day or so? Because studies have shown that maximum rotation occurs within 1 hour after surgery and within 1 day after surgery. So would you some lifestyle restrictions for the patient that undergoes a toric IOL?
No, sir. I'm not aware of that, sir.
I don't think it's practical. Right? I mean, in today's world, people want to
at least the first 1 hour.
Yeah. I don't think so. I think it's more to do with gravity. So even if the patient sits up, there can be the IOL can rotate. So it is not just being active. I'm not sure.
Okay, now, I mean, we have done everything that is possible, and then there is an astigmatic surprise in the postoperative period. So the question is, how do you know whether a mere rotation of the lens will suffice, or you will have to go for IOL exchange or whatever? So how do you know?
I think the Barrett toric surprise calculator clearly gives you a message that you need an IOL exchange or you can rotate. So for the starter, I think that's more than enough. Of course, we have to look at the spherical equivalent, as I mentioned. If it is too high, then there's no point in rotating, because ultimately you will end up with a spherical error.
So what is acceptable? When do you say too high? It is 0.25, 0.5, 0.75?
It depends on patient's expectation, but I think 0.5 to 0.75 is fairly enough on myopic side. Hyperopic patients don't accept much. So
then we have to go for other means other than rotation.
Yeah.
And how much of residual astigmatism is tolerated by the patient after toric IOL surgery? When the lens has rotated, when do you go in for an intervention?
It also depends on patient's expectation. In my patients, up to 0.75, they easily tolerate. And if bilaterally operated, I think they can tolerate even more because they don't look at, you know, monocular vision.
Anybody would like to comment on this?
I think that's a very correct point, that up to 0.5, 0.75, sometimes even up to 1 diopter, you know, if you talk to the patient, they hardly, over a period of time, they realize that although the optometrist measured them and gave them the prescription, they don't necessarily need to use them with both eyes. So I would be very cautious in doing an intraocular procedure again for half or quarter diopter or 0.75 diopter of residual astigmatism.
And I think the spherical equivalent is important. So if you have spherical equivalent 0, then usually patients do not require the cylinder.
So another thing, I mean, Tom, I'd like to ask you is, you know, I mean, instead of approaching all these calculators and all, why don't we measure the steep axis of the cornea? And then if the lens is not lying on the steep axis, you rotate the lens and bring it, align it to the steep axis. So is that, I mean, it should work out, isn't it?
Well, I hear what you're saying. In other words, just measure the cornea yourself and then just adjust it. I have always used fixed my astigmatism from Berdahl, which is very similar to these other sites. I found that to be very useful. It's also sometimes a little bit counterintuitive how much change you can get with what the rotation is. Sometimes it's not exactly what I predicted. So I guess I would just use one of those sites because it's reassuring, if nothing else, and double checks to make sure you haven't made an error, particularly if the original reason for the problem was because of an error that I made. So I find those sites really useful. Usually we don't check until a month anyway. So we usually do the surgery, see them that night, and then we don't see them again for a month. So we don't know anything until a month anyway. So we've already waited a reasonable amount of time. And so we would just proceed right then. But it's pretty rare that we have to do these rotations, honestly. To me, the most worrisome patient is a high myope where the lens is placed at 90. And I think that's because there's more room in the sulcus, you know, at 90. And so, there's more room at 180 than there is at 90. And so there's a tendency for the lens to want to rotate to 180. And so those are the highest risk. We have had one or two of those over time that we had trouble and had to reposition them a couple times. And we've done things like place capsular tension rings. I think one of our surgeons here did a reverse optic capture to try to keep it in position. But those are the riskiest ones, high myopes at 90.
If you have a dialysis and you have done a CTR or Sionis ring fixation of the back, would you still have the inclination to go in for a toricoid in that case? Intraoperative complications, zonular dialysis with CTR, and sutured device onto the scleral coat. So would you go for a toricoid in that situation or you'll abandon it?
Well, you mean, in other words, if you pre-op before the surgery, you have some other issue?
No,
So I if there's an intraoperative issue with weakened zonules or some issue, you know, where I'm nervous about either long-term stability of the zonules or short-term my ability to place a single piece of acrylic, then yeah, I would definitely abort the toric lens. Some people have suggested the idea of reverse optic capture for toric lenses when the posterior capsule is not intact. I think Ike is off our call. He's had several cases like that. I think Jason Jones had several cases like that where the posterior capsule was not intact. Because of a desire to place a toric lens, it was still placed in the reverse optic capture configuration. I have not tended not to do that. I've tended to place a lens in the sulcus and traditional optic capture prolapsed it back, and then later dealt with the astigmatism in another manner with a laser or something else.
In fact, before you could join in, I know you had some joining issues. Dr. Shail had shown exactly the same case where a toric patient had a PC rent and he had performed a reverse optic capture and the patient had done extremely well. And that was one of your cases, isn't it, Shail?
Yes, that's correct. But the point is absolutely correct. In case of any doubt, avoid a single piece IOL in the back.
About the high myopia, I think use of CTR is a very good way to manage the toric IOL because it stretches the back end kind of flattens the anterior and posterior capsule. So for about 26 millimeter axial length, I always go for CTR implantation in high myopes.
Exactly. What are the dimension of the CTR?
It's 11-13.
11-13. So the standard CTR.
Standard one, yeah.
So I think we are approaching our closing time. So can we just have one comment from each speaker? You know, the take-home message for on any aspect of the deliberations or the cases that we have discussed today. Starting with Madhu, just one point take-home message for the audience.
One question for all the panelists. If there is gross rotation in toric IOL and if patient is having more than 5 diopter of astigmatism, whether we can wait for 2 weeks to 3 weeks for rotation, or we can take it on the next day.
What would you do, Haripriya?
I prefer to wait for about 2 weeks as the preferred time. With too early, I find the bag may be too loose and there's a chance of rotation is again high, especially in a patient with high astigmatism. The chance, even if you have a small rotation, the patient will surface with more residual astigmatism. So I'd like to wait for 2 weeks. For the accuracy of the hydrophobic lens, the capsule adheres to the IOL much faster than the hydrophilic. So the orotoric, I could wait up to 3 weeks, whereas a hydrophobic within 2 weeks. Again, beyond that, it kind of adheres. So I like to rotate them under BSS or ringer lactate without using viscoelastic. So 2 weeks is the best time for me for most rotations. Again, at 1 day post-op, I would also ensure we mark the position of the lens. And again, we see all our patients at 3 weeks. But in case we have a difference in terms of the refraction or the rotation is too much, then we'll call the patient back in about 10 days and then decide.
Deepak, anything?
Yeah, I just within 10 days to 2 weeks. I don't think I can wait beyond that. And because the patient is also unhappy, we need to address that also. And the lens gets sticky. It becomes difficult to, especially if you're using a hydrophobic lens. So less than 2 weeks is my ideal choice.
Ryan?
Yeah, I was thinking about the reverse capture. I find that having the lexis size, large enough is very important. We tend to do a smaller lexis nowadays for better IOL stability. But having a good lexis size is very important. And when we land up in these kinds of scenarios, maybe the lexis size is not big enough to get a reverse capture, reverse optic capture in place.
I think we had a very prolonged session and a lot of interesting points came up. Lovely videos were shown. And I would like to thank Dr. Namrata is here. Thank you, Dr. Namrata, for facilitating this particular webinar. I would also like to thank the Microvision for doing a lot of good work and making it possible for the webinar to take place. Thank you, Ashok, and your team. And thank you to all the speakers and the panel members, Dr. Tom, Dr. Rashail, Madhu, Saurav, Sayan, Dr. Haripriya, and Dr. Deepak. So thank you once again and have a good night. I think it's time for dinner too here in India. And time for lunch there at your place, Tom?
Yes, lunch. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Great interaction and great scientific discussion. Congratulations, Dr. Roop, for getting it all in place. Wonderful. I could only see the latter part of it, but wonderful scientific discussion. And you had a huge viewership like always. So congratulations, Dr. Roop, and all the other speakers. Great.
Thank you, Dr. Namrata. Okay, then till we meet next.